Are we in the right room?
You are in the right room.
Alright.
There's color in
my room.
Are you filming us?
The reason I'm filming you is I'm supposed to be observed by my tutor today from the PGCE.
Ah.
But he can't make it, so that's the only reason it's being filmed, is so that he can grade me as part of my assessment.
Right.
So I will ask everybody when everyone's here if that's okay, but they're not actually, both of them, that one isn't even on, that one's, I've got a radio mic.
Okay, yeah.
So that's not even recording.
Right.
That one is actually on me, rather than you guys, so it's all on me, rather than you. And I have a GoPro, but that's, yeah. That's the microphone rather than anything else, because what they want to know is...
Mary's tutor, who's nothing, can't actually be here physically today.
Okay.
So that's what they can't.
But they're nothing to... I'm going to reassure everybody.
You only have so much charisma, we just steal the camera.
Well, that's why I said, can I do it with the MA group, because they're pug ugly. And I'm all good. No, I'm only teasing.
No. I'm posing for art.
I better start behaving myself because I'm supposed to send him everything from the point that the students start to arrive into the room. So I didn't say, oh, no, you're lovely. You're right. So I'm going to put you in groups. But this, I'm worried that I'm not going to get enough students to make three.
Because, we were told we had to come.
Yeah.
That's what they had to come.
Yeah,
woo!
So grab a seat. I may move you around once you're seated.
Okay.
Just to even you out a little bit. Probably the easiest thing to do is to designate somewhere. If you put all the bags and coats maybe just along here in a line, because otherwise it just, you know, gets messy. And we'll lock the door at break so everything is safe. But if you want your laptops and stuff on your tables, that's fine. Sometimes people like to follow this on Blackboard, but I put it on a desk of release. So we're only going to
hold
on to Blackboard.
I know.
By all means, have it. I don't mind. The only thing you need really is.
Exactly.
Your mouth. No, the opposite.
I left it at home. It didn't send the email.
Oh, no. I was going to say, could you bring your own colours? And then I thought, no, I'm going down to the shop and I'm going to put my hand in my pocket and I'm going to have three packets of markers.
All the spots.
So, yeah. And if you're, I don't know, is the room warm or cold? Because I thought it was roasting earlier.
Well,
so,
I'm not sure, like, I have the food
right
now, so.
I don't know. If your head starts revolving and you start speaking in tongues, we know it's just the food.
Yes.
Turn the radiators off, but
if anyone
at any point.
I feel so
if you want pens, you're going to be drawing, so if you have your favourite drawing pen, bring that. But I've put anything you want, but I've put pens and pencils on the table as well, so you can. It's only if you have your own stuff and you want to use it, then that's absolutely fine. Sorry. So you didn't have anything else this morning?
Yeah.
You just came in. Thank you very much. I think Chris is joining us.
He's just with
the... He's with Sandra. I think he's going to join us as a student rather than a tutor.
I
definitely have two more.
We definitely have Laura Beth, because I've seen her. Sandra's here. Has anyone seen anyone else that they know is coming?
Yes, we've got three more coming down the corridor. It's going to work.
Because Wednesday is kind of like an awkward.
It is. I know. I'm sorry. I actually had wanted to start at 2, and to be honest, we're probably not really going to get going properly until 2. But it was Chris had originally this slot on the timetable with you.
You had said 2 at the start, and so far.
Exactly, you see. But Chris said, hello. Right, we've got to spread you out over a table, so you're going to be moving around, so don't panic if you don't wind up with your... See, and you're going to sit there with the boys, and you're going to sit there with the girls, and then I'm going to have to... Right, no, sit where you want. No, sit wherever you want.
I have my same phone.
No, sit where you want, and I'll see how many people turn
just
on.
Make you
do it. That's what I'll do. I'll force you to sit beside.
The
boys
are
cheers. There you go. just to keep the room a little bit passable, because I want people to be able to move around. We're going to put bikes and coats just by the wall, but that's fine there. But yeah, just to make sure that people can get around the tables. Right, we'll just hang on for another 2 minutes. It's just gone 1:30, and then we'll make a start. In the meantime, we can all... Now, I'm going to ask you to do something for me, and I'm going to have to apologise for asking you to do this, but I haven't really taught all of you guys together since September, October time, and I am not good with names, so would you mind, please, I do think I know most of your names, but just so I don't embarrass myself by calling you by the wrong name, could you, there's some paper here, could you just write your name, just your first name, with the black pens that are in the centre, just like that, and just stand it up so I can see the name, because otherwise I'm going to be going, Thank you. And there's pens in the centre. Oh, you didn't get a pen. I think I'm okay, Danny, unless you were desperate to join. You're welcome to, but I think I've got enough. We're open to, as long as I can see the name.
Maybe
you
have
the old one.
Oh.
You
know, see if
she
looks right.
Hello!
Here we go, here.
We're getting a very interesting dynamic going on. I think, Thomas, we may be moving you over to this table. No, not yet, because if Chris comes. If Chris comes on, we'll move one of you guys off the end there onto this table. So we have three groups, four groups of three.
We've set up a double name tag for you.
Okay. So what does that mean? No, it needs to be facing me so I can see. So you're going to need one each. Hello!
Are you allowed both?
I've just now been actually doing this, so it's been a long time since I've taught you. Just in case we get interrupted, but what this session is called and what it's about is integrated theory of practice. I've got some outcomes and I've got some points just to sort of ease you guys in. Before we get onto that part of it, I wanted to just talk to you a little bit about what we're doing. We're going to be doing two tasks The first one is only going to take about 10 minutes. We're going to be doing that in the next 10 to 15 minutes. It's a really simple drawing task, and I'll tell you more about it when we get to it. They are non-assessed. This is not about the quality of the artwork. This is not about your kind of conceptual ideas. I will be telling you what the session is about when we get started. But some of the data from the tasks may be used. What I'm in the middle of at the moment, as some of you know, is I'm doing my PGCE. And we have to do a research project. So I'm doing a research project on a very particular aspect of education. And some of the information that you're presenting today may be used in that. It's going to be used in a sort of a 80% of students who wear short sleeve shirts, and they prefer pink and they prefer green. It's very simple data. It's not that I'm going to be asking for you to bare your soul on paper or anything like that. It's also, it can be anonymous. It doesn't have to be, you can put a name down, but it's just about gathering information. So it may be used, it may not be used. Ethically, I have to tell you that I'm doing this. Ethically, the university has an ethics committee that if I present the data in the research project and if I go to publish the research project, I need to be very clear that I have been morally and ethically critical and careful of my work. So the point is, at the end of the session today, if you submit the task, that is indicating that you're happy for me to use the data from the task. If you don't, all you have to do is scrunch up your paper and put it in the bin on the way out. Okay? I'm not going to go around and, well, I am going to go around and gather in the tasks, but that's just so we can see what people have done. And then I leave them, probably over on the windowsill, and if anybody wants to, you can just, so it, you know, you don't have to tell me that you don't want to be part of it, you just throw away your submission. If you do not wish to take part, please leave your task work here or take it away with you. So you could do that as well, you could pop it in your bag and take it away with you. This all sounds terribly, but it is just part of what they're doing with us on the course is they're doing what they call modelling. They're modelling research activity, scholarly activity, which is expected of academic staff. For any of you thinking you might want to do a PhD at some point, this is the kind of thing that you need, if you can start to get your head around these processes, or even for any of you with an MA that want to get into a research capacity, so anyone thinking of going into education or teaching, is it on, kind of on people's radars? There's lots of research positions every year advertised, and they can be sort of PhD or MPhil or different qualifications, but quite often attached to those little posts within institutions is the understanding that you will conduct academic research. So it's a useful thing to start to get your head around. The policy and the processes are actually very illuminating. Does anyone here read lots of academic papers? Okay, we are going to talk a little bit about it today. It's not going to be that much of a focus today on the class, but I do want to talk to you a little bit about kind of getting to know your craft, getting to know your form in a broader context. That's sort of part of what we're doing today. So if I can just go back. There we go. Okay, so I'm going to assume we've got everybody. So integrating theory and practice. Where last semester, can anybody give me an example of where you were absolutely engaged with learning about practice? A session, an exercise, a project. Where were you practically engaged in the craft of animation?
Your lip sync.
My lip sync exercise. So why would you quantify that as practice rather than theory?
You were actively doing.
Can anyone think of any aspect of that session that may have touched on or crossed over, or any practical session that you did with me where we crossed over or we touched on theory? Of any description?
Yeah, when you talked about the mouth shapes, the whole set.
So we talked about the mouth shapes and we talked about things like plosives and how the mouth was shaped to make an M or a B or a P shape. That's very much touching on theory. If we had a student who was then hoping to go on to study maybe art therapy, which we have had on the masters, we we've had people who've done that route. They may have well chosen that as a subject to investigate and looked at the theory behind teaching lip sync to students who are deaf. We had a student a good few years ago who made that her entire research agenda for her level 3 dissertation, was about how animation and lip sync can really help when teaching young children how to lip read. So there are routes, and really that's sort of what this session is about today. The aim of the session is to help you guys to identify and sustain essential connections. We're looking at a very difficult area of practice. We're looking at taking the practical things that we enjoy, and they're probably for a lot of us the reasons why we're here. We're starting to look at the theory, and some of the theory that you would have covered last semester, some of the research you're doing at the moment to do with your own films, your own ideas, and it's that uncomfortable place in between. How does my practice connect to theory? And you're on the professional practice module at the moment, yes? Yeah, so some of the stuff that you're doing on the professional practice module will help you in that respect, because a lot of the language, critical analysis, comes into some of that teaching. But that's just to clarify. So really, we're looking at identify and sustain. What do I mean by the word sustain? Why would we need something to help us sustain this activity, this idea of mixing theory and practice? So you're working on your films. Are you likely to say, oh, fantastic, I have a whole day free, I'm going to the library to read about animation theory. To hell with my room. I'm not going to look at my character. I'm going to go to... Why do we need to sustain it? Because it's not necessarily the underlying reason why we came to study animation. So up hands anyone here who came here because they wanted to get a really theoretical grasp of their craft. Up hands anyone here who came here because they wanted to make films and learn how to animate. Okay, the point of this session is to try and show you that learning how to make films and how to animate must, if you're doing this at master's level, if you're doing this at a high level of inquiry, you must start to figure out ways of making connections. And there'll be different connections for every single one of you. Why?
Different practices.
And it's not on that slide.
Sort of different cultures.
Different cultures, you're all different people. So you're not going to necessarily get excited or get interested in the same subject matter. You're not all exploring the same subject matter in your film. So this isn't about saying you must go away and read this book or this book or this book. It's about showing you, modeling some behavior. So I've just had a quick look at your module outcomes, and this is from your developing practice. And the reason I've put this up is that at master's level, it is really important that we bring forward learning from previous projects and from previous modules. Quite often, students will get a head of steam up, you'll get a lot of work done, you'll be very engaged in certain things, like pre-production last semester. And then the feeling is you move into production, and certain things are, well, that's done, I can now focus on this. And actually, at master's level, we would need you to understand that the modules build on each other. So, at the end of last semester, you were assessed. And you were assessed against these three. Now, these are selected from a list. So, are these familiar? So, did anyone tell me where you'd find these?
On the module brief.
On the module brief. And where's the module brief?
Blackboard.
Okay, so if you're not really familiar with these, or if you need to re-familiarize yourself, to build on your experience in semester one, so I've added that sentence. That wasn't there last semester. That would have been confusing. Drawing together considered and appropriate aspects of your practice. So considered and appropriate means it's not going to be the same aspects for everybody. You consider it and you pick what's appropriate to you. Through theoretical study, practical application and research activities. So you had lectures last semester that were on the theory side of things. They wouldn't have been with me. Anyone tell me one of those lectures?
Any of Lewis's.
So what kind of ground did Lewis cover in his lectures?
Directing,
so narrative strategy possibly, some film theory I would imagine.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anybody extend that learning? Did anyone kind of pick up on something that Lewis might have mentioned and kind of gone and read around it a little bit?
Yeah.
What, Thomas, you put your
mind? I took out a book on script writing.
Right.
And I've been reading.
And you've been reading it, and is it theory based? I mean, it's not, yeah, so it's beyond what font to use and where to, how to lay out your paragraphs.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're on anyone else? Yeah?
I did the same thing.
Same thing. So this is sort of, this is where you should be this semester. You've sort of remodeled that, and the idea is that you should be independently getting excited and seeking information beyond what is presented to you, something different for every single person. To continue the process of familiarization with contemporary animation production. Contemporary animation production, ladies and gentlemen, isn't all about practical stuff. There's, you know, if you're, especially if you're wanting to go into maybe freelance work or setting up your own business, or writing about animation, maybe becoming a critic. I mean, thinking of Ben, I mean, Ben is an animator, Ben is an author, Ben is a critic, Ben is an enthusiast. There's so many niches in the kind of media world, and part of your job is to understand contemporary animation production, distribution, and consumption. It isn't just about the software you used, the colors you used. Those are very important, but you need to have a broader understanding of what's going on. And it's not just industry. It's what's going on within the form. So you think of animation as a form, and you might look at children's animation, you might look at short form, experimental work. There's lots of different contexts. And then the last one is, we're expecting you to begin to develop an ability to adapt research methodologies. Research methodologies? Anyone, have you done research methodologies? Did we talk about this last semester? Nobody mentioned research methodologies. Right, so if I'm doing some research on something, so I want to say I'm doing a children's film, and I am making a decision based on the age group of the children that I want to aim it at, I might read a book, I might sort of look at a journal online, but I might just do a little survey amongst my classmates, or I might ask Chris, can I come into the first year group and just, you know, show of hands, how many of you at the age of six were aware of such and such, gather the data. So it's about doing a little bit of analysis of something beyond simply reading sort of somebody else's words. Selected module outcomes, this is this semester. And actually this semester is the point where you're supposed to be engaging in your production and in your film. And this session has been placed here to say that you also bring all of that stuff from the previous semester, but in a way that is very resonant and relevant to you and to your practice. So the ability to engage in a critical evaluation of work, both within the context of, it says, the production team, you may be a team of one, and as an individual practitioner. When you hand in your work, when you hand in the stuff at the end of this module, you are handing in a written piece. Yes?
Mm-hmm.
That's an evaluative piece. Is it 2,000 words?
Yeah.
So quite often that can be misinterpreted at an early point as, I'm just going to talk about my progress, what I discovered, my learning, and that is really important and really central. But you are, at master's level, expected to place that within a broader context at key points. It might only be two times or three times throughout that, but again, if you were talking about film that deals with immigration, so if your film has a message, you would be expected to have some understanding of current debates or theories or government papers. So it's just about researching around your subject. Okay. So the session outline, we're just about on track with it, is session introduction and aims, which we've done. Practical task one we're about to do now. And then as soon as that's finished, we'll go into the main seminar. Now that is not a lecture, okay? Those of you, well, you all know me. I don't lecture, I don't stand and talk at people for an hour. We're doing. So there's going to be a little bit of talk, a lot of me asking you. The easiest thing to do, just as a bit of a ground rule, is just put your hand up, okay? And if a lot of people want to speak, I will go, okay, first Mike, then Laura Beth, then Fiona, okay? If I'm having to drag it out of you, I will just say, okay, Laura Beth, you look like you have a question on your face. But I'd rather not do that. So hands up if you have a question. If the conversation is nice and gentle, we might just sort of throw it around a little bit. So I'm more of a moderator. What I am really interested in today is you guys actually starting to form opinions, and you guys, I'm sure you have opinions, but feeling quite happy to share those. We're talking about becoming a community of practice today, so we're going to be picking up ideas from each other. So the main presentation topic is going to go on for about 40 minutes. And then I'm going to set the second task, and the second task is going to go on for the rest of the session. So the second task is quite a long, sort of guided, supported, independent session. So you'll be working in the teams on the table, okay? And then we're going to stop at 4:20, and we're going to have a peer review. And you'll notice I put coffee in bright red, so that we are having coffee. May not be exactly at 3, and I may give you more than 20 minutes. I'd hope to give you a half an hour to give you time to get down and back up again. I would ask that you don't bring coffee back in. Okay, so I'll give you a good half hour, try and have the coffee dry before you come back into the class. Okay? So, any questions? Are we intrigued? Excited? Worried? Cold? Is everybody okay with the room, temperature-wise? Yep, okay. So, practical task one. I'm going to give you some paperwork, and these are the ground rules for this task. So please complete it, and it'll be fairly self-evident when I send it round how to complete it. I'd like you to work independently. Please do not discuss it with anyone else on the table, okay? Because I want this to be very much, we open up the discussion after the task has been completed. So it's like exam time. When I was in primary school, our teacher used to say, put your fingers on your lips. Just in the spirit of the exercise. It's a drawing exercise, but it's a simple sketch. You are not going to be judged on the quality of your drawing. This is not a drawing exercise. So put as much effort into it as you want to. We're not spending a lot of time on this. So a quick sketch is fine, and it's a warm-up task for later on. So it's not something that we're, you know, we are going to take a quick look at them. We're not even going to look at who drew what. Okay, we're just going to back them on under the visualizer. So I need to think about this for a second. I've got enough papers. Okay. Now there's a little folded back section. Can I ask you don't fold the section back and you don't flip the paper over until you've completed the task? This is really primary school stuff, but you'll understand why in a minute. So please don't do that. So that's there's pencils and paper. I don't mind what you draw with, what you use. Okay. Actually, I want to just make a little substitution. You'll understand that they're slightly different. There we go. Okay. about 3-4 more minutes, so if you need to speed up, speed up. If you're finished, you can add detail if you want. Or you can just sit and be happy. It's a quick sketch, so you know, if one foot is slightly bigger than the other or something, that's not the end of the world. I think actually going around, we probably only need about one more minute. So can you just before, don't anybody flip the paper back, so just if you're finished or if you're nearly finished, just make sure that if you read through the paper, you've completed the task in front of you. Just look at your own paper. We almost there? All right. Can you now flip open the paper? So just stay on that side. Don't flip it over, but just open it. If you've nothing written, there's nothing on the flap, you can turn it over and fill out the other side. If there's something written on the flap, can you fill that in, please? And then turn it over. So if there's nothing there, yeah, you can turn yours over. You can just fill yours out and then turn it over. Yeah, so I can. Say that again. It doesn't matter. It's finished enough. It's beautiful. Yeah, yeah. As long as you've completed the first side, so you can flip it over. Yeah. And you can chat now. I don't mind. You don't have to be so. If you want to talk to each other, if you want to stay very quiet and focused, it's totally up to you. So once you've.
At least you have courage for me.
That's for you.
What caused the list of it?
Exactly. Some of them would be on something rather strange, I would imagine. And again, for the sake of the research exercise, the course you're on is just, I'm going to probably run a similar exercise with undergraduates. So I'm interested to know if the MA response is different to the undergrad response. So that's why it's asking for that information. If you have any questions, just shout. Yeah, that's exact. That's all really good information. I'm hoping everybody has something slightly different. I'm hoping everybody has different boxes ticked on the other side, so. Yeah, it doesn't matter. Yeah. Are we almost there?
What's the fault of this?
Sorry?
What do you consider yourself?
It's, and that can be.
In the
yeah.
Sorry,
maybe I can.
Yeah, no, that's yeah. Fill that in if you want to.
Okay.
If there's anything useful. I'm just going to give you another minute or two. Just that last section is really. Can you try and put at least one sentence in that last section? I'm interested in your trajectory on the project. There's not a right answer or a wrong answer. I'm trying to tease out some information. So if there's something that you think influenced you or impacted on you, if you could just put a few points in that section, that would be fantastic. And if you're finished, you can flip your drawing. I don't want you to go back to your drawing, please. So don't anyone go back to their drawing, because I don't want you to now recode a drawing based on what you know the exercise is about. Okay, are we all there? Just while the last few people are finishing off, this is my thank you. I said, I had to pitch this yesterday, and they said, how are you going to persuade students to do this? And I said, oh, chocolate.
This is positive reinforcement.
This is positive reinforcement. It's for Pavlovian response. Yes. Well, do you not eat chocolate on Thursday?
No, no, it's just, I'm still thinking about what Ben said. I had to tour with him yesterday.
He's going to pop in, so I'm
not
sure.
I'm
making myself bolder.
It's okay.
Okay.
Are we ready? Everybody ready?
I have to work
You're
it out.
You're going to be 26 this year.
I have to work it out. That's really sad. Results. I'm going to take them off, but not quite yet. So, could I have a show of hands? How many people had a totally genderless character, that gender just did not even come into the equation? Okay, can I ask you, did you have the paper that had it folded back to name the character?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, good. That's what I wanted to know. How many of you drew a character that was absolutely female from the start? Oh, I love you guys. I love you guys. That's brilliant. So for the rest of you, how many of you drew a gender-neutral character that then became male when you were asked to name it? Excellent. Brilliant. Excellent. That's exactly... So happy. And how many of you, it was just male, it was never a question, it was going to be male anyway. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that interesting? So up hands again, how many of you attributed a male gender when asked? Up hands? So one, two, three, four of you, three girls and one boy. And how many of you, it just wasn't even, it wasn't a question. It was absolutely male from the start.
I agree with these guys.
Okay, no, that's okay. That's better because that really proves my theory. So hands up nice and high. So one, two, three, four. And for how many of you was gender not an issue until two of you and both of you went down the male route? Yeah, this is brilliant. Right, we are going to look at the characters, but we're going to look at them when we move on to task two. Okay? Yeah, you're welcome to come. We have just done the exercise, Chris, which is a shame. But yeah, you want to sit there. Right, so now that I've sort of revealed that, we can talk a little bit more about the session. If I had told you that the session was about representations of gender, we would not, Chris, we got exactly the results. Exactly the results. Really, really, really good. I'm delighted with you. But if we had said that, if I'd overtly said, then you would have second-guessed. So what we want to do is we wanted to look at theory and practice, and the particular theory, the particular aspect of practice that I chose to talk about is gender. And for two reasons. One is it's the one thing that probably affects most of your films. Is there anybody here who's doing a film that has no character, no gendered character whatsoever?
Doing multiple films and one of them's about a robot.
But does the robot have a gender? Do you naturally think of it as a he or a she?
I mean, I have to use a pronoun to refer to it. I do use he.
That's fine. There's no judgment here. This is just to
but
say...
I do wish there was a gender-neutral pronoun that we could use, because they is so clunky.
It is. And I think part of my kind of theory is that language is a lot to do with why certain things happen at certain points. So what we're looking at today, for the next sort of 30 minutes, is notion of gender. Now, my original plan was to look at male, female, and transgendered characters. You would need another session to look at male characters and another session to look at transgendered. So I had started to put it together, and it was so light that I thought, for N-level students, we're not going to be able to get through this. So today, I've chosen to focus on female characters, not for any political reason. Okay, so this isn't a session on feminism, and this isn't a session on men versus women or women versus men, or this is a session on notions of representation. Why did I choose this? A, because it's relevant to all of you, or to most of you for your films. B, it is quite important that we take responsibility, we being myself and Chris and the other members of the team, to highlight these issues, because as soon as you get into industry, as soon as you get into even in sort of independent film, there is a responsibility on you as young filmmakers to not just sort of fit into an industry, but to change that industry. and that the notions of gender are undergoing a massive revolution, and it's happened, it's been a long, slow burn, but we've got a couple of subject matters, a couple of films in the zeitgeist at the moment that we're going to talk about a bit later, which have opened up huge debates about it. I studied my master's I finished in 2005, so 10 years ago, and the landscape and the sort of the cultural theory about animation and gender in those 10 years has massively changed. And it's going to change again over the next 5 years. So has everyone had a chance to just read through that?
Yeah.
Okay. So key issues around female character design. There are a lot of conversations around sexuality and character design. There's a lot of conversations about sort of gender roles and character design. So I've just picked some very general statements. Representations of gender in animation have historically reflected social and political attitudes of the day. So something that was made in America in the 1920s is going to reflect, unless it was specifically made to challenge those attitudes, it's going to reflect those attitudes. So can anybody give me an example of a piece of animation that very much reflects the time or the place that it was made in?
Betty Boop.
Betty Boop. Okay. So what do we know about Betty Boop?
She was created sort of late 20s, early 30s, a flapper type dancer based on an actress.
Does anybody else know anything about Betty Boop?
Not really.
Anybody know what age Betty Boop was supposed to have been? Actually, I'm going to all going to mix it up now. I'm going to put you with the boys. Yeah. Okay.
16.
She was 16. That was the age of the character, which now would be quite shocking. To sexualize any character in that way would be quite subversive or quite shocking. So that's a massive sea change. We're not talking specifically about gender, but we're talking about the sexualization of a character has changed massively. And it's also, if Betty Boop, or if a character like Betty Boop had emerged 20 years later in the UK, the thrust of the design might have been the same, but the coding would have been different. And we're going to talk about the coding of the character in a second. The design standard has been to code females. Sorry. We go back to that top point. Representations have reflected social and political attitudes of the day, with female characters mainly existing as wife, girlfriend, or love interest for the male protagonist. Of course, there are characters where you could say, oh, this is an exception because of this, or this is an exception because of that. And I'm generalizing here, and I'm talking mainly around the notions of feature, or very, very prominent TV. So something like The Flintstones, something like Family Guy. I'm keeping it that general simply for time, because you could do a whole lecture on short film, you could do a whole lecture on advertising or music video, where you could discuss different aspects of the same central kind of conceit. And non-desirable women have their own set of codes. So if I were to ask you now, in groups, we have our groups, this isn't a drawing exercise, so this is simply, I just want you to have a little discussion. And I'm going to give you out some A3 paper. So in groups, I want you to identify three visual codes used in animation character design that signify a character is female. Okay? In a group, so you can decide on three between you. And I want you to analyze and interpret each code. That's just going to be a sentence or two. So I'll give you a couple of bits of paper. You can do some scratchy notes, or you can just write them down as you think them. We're going to get them up on the board, and we're going to have a chat about them when we finish the exercise, okay? So identify three visual codes. So something like the voice, I'm not interested in. Okay, it's visual, and it's not about how it animates, it's how the design reads. So try and imagine a design artifact rather than moving image, okay? So three codes that tells us that a character is female. Analyze and interpret the code. So don't just say, well, you know, got boobs, it's a female. Try and think about the implications of that. In terms of communicating to an audience, and then feedback key findings. We'll do this very, very quickly, so the key findings we might just even pop around the tables. Okay, so just have a chat, and if you need any clarification, give me a shout and I'll come around.
Okay.
There's loads of paper there, so probably. Anything visual, anything that you can see with your eyes.
So, things like horses, hips,
Okay,
guys, we're going to hold there. And we're just going to write down very quickly some of our findings.
We all
have at least three. Does everybody have at least three on each table?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we're probably going to have the same ones come up. So if you're the last group and you don't have that many, just add to anything that you think makes yours slightly different, or you know, if you've said the same thing in different language. What I'll actually do is I'll go around the tables to get one, and then I'll go around a second time, and then I'll go around a third time. So if we start with you guys, give me one.
Colour.
Colour.
The female penguin itself has a little bit of pink on her chest, and none of the other penguins have that.
Okay, so is that to identify the character, or to identify the character as female?
As female.
Okay.
Because she's already a colour species, so she's easy to identify.
So how would you identify a character through colour? By using a colour that is associated with that. For good or bad, pink is a girl, blue is a boy. Although that is starting to actually change slightly. Okay, let's move around and I'll come back to you again. So through colour, you guys, can you give me one? I'll come around again, so we'll...
Eyelashes.
What about eyelashes?
They're flirtatious.
I'm going to write flirting. Because I don't think I can spell flirtatious.
They also make a character look a bit more babyish.
Okay, good. So, baby-like or child-like?
They also look
like... Hang on, we're not finished. So, a visual code tells us the character is female. Is the long eyelashes exclusively used on infant characters?
No.
So, baby-like, well, equals female.
And also in general, I mean, most animated characters are diminutive size or infant size in some way.
It's part of the genre,
like,
isn't it?
Proportions, for example.
Yeah, so it's a way of making something cute or appealing. So we're, you know, we know that as animators there's a lot going on other than gender. But if we come back to gender, baby-like, flirty, we're not talking small infant characters. So what we're saying is if the eyelashes are they're big, thank you, long. So long eyelashes means the character's flirty and baby-like, and it also tells us it's a female. I'm just leaving that one there. Okay?
I think if you had two like really simple faces, one with eyelashes and one without, the one with eyelashes would be
a female. And is that a political choice?
I think it's just a stylistic choice because The Simpsons is a great example.
Yeah, so it's I think it's the same point that Tom was making, that Carol is making, that it's a pragmatic thing. We're not looking at live action. You know, you're unlikely to have a room full of actors who all have a level of androgyny that means we don't know whether they're male or female. So we code females. So eyelashes can sometimes simply say that this is the female version of. Okay? I still come back to why. And I think that's the question. Yes, you can say it's simply a pragmatic decision. But why? Why eyelashes?
It's associated with makeup.
It's makeup, but it also is baby-like, it's flirty. So the baby-like, flirty character has the eyelashes, and is the female. And I'm just going to leave it there. I'm going to come around to you guys, and we'll come back around again. So...
These are not my thoughts, I'm just writing stuff down. Body shape,
good.
Exaggerated, curves.
Yeah.
Typically in exaggerated things like hips being larger, waists being slimmer, and an example was given from a friend of mine who said said Mrs. Incredible, but I quite liked her to be called Elastigirl, because Mrs. is actually...
You think Mrs.
is being owned by Mr. Incredible.
Anyone else have a comment on that? Is Elastigirl?
I initially said Helen Parr, if you remember.
I think it's interesting to say and again, this isn't a personally held view, but there are schools of thought that would say calling a grown-ass woman a girl necessarily isn't a good idea either. And the thing is, this is a minefield. This is where we have to try and divorce ourselves from these conversations. We're here as designers, we're here as animators. We're not here to kind of politicize, or so we're not too worried about political correctness today. In fact, there's a task further down where I'm going to ask you to be as politically incorrect as you possibly can. Yeah, okay. So if we go around, so we've got three very good visual codes there. We've got colour, we've got eyelashes, and we've got body shape. There's a lot with body shape. So I'm just going to go around again really quickly and get three more. So have you another one there that hasn't been said already?
Yeah, we have the hair.
Hair. What about the hair?
Well, generally they're longer.
Yeah, I think, I mean, fair enough. Longer hair, or it's usually hair shape. It's about the silhouette, so that, you know, there's plaits, or if there's a... having said that, look at any group of 18-year-old students, there'll be as many males almost as females that will have long hair or a bun or something like that. So it's a code that tells us something. It's not necessarily a contemporary code, but we're usually about 10 years behind when things become recoded, so it still stands. And one more from you guys?
Colored lips.
Lips, good. I'm going to put that up here with eyelashes. So it's not just the lips, it's the colour.
Colour or like they're really defined.
Or they're really defined. So colour or shape of lips.
Like, for example, on a male character, you might just have, it'll just be a line maybe, but on a female character, there will always, 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 always be lips.
Yeah. And usually, what about the colour?
Red.
Pink.
Okay, so again, I don't necessarily want to discuss this, but why do we associate red lips with female? Why do women wear lipstick? We're not going to discuss this, we'll discuss it further down the line, but I want you to think about these reasons. So the codes themselves, as Thomas pointed out, are quite pragmatic. It's to signify it's a woman, and I want you to dig a little bit further back and go, okay, but why have these things come to signify it? Why are red lips or long eyelashes indicative? My eyelashes are probably no longer than anyone else's in this room. My lips are no redder than anyone else's. So why have we come to see these as codes? Okay, and the last one from you guys?
Well, they nicked some of ours.
Well,
but they did say about the shape of the head and the shape of the face.
Good.
Oval and being softer.
Softer?
Yeah, so more curved, less rigid jaws, that kind of thing.
Would it be fair to say more feminine? Not a bad word. I'm just going to write fem, because it's awkward to write.
Yes,
of course you can.
Also the noses, I think. Oops. Because male figures tend to have like bigger noses, and female ones tend to have a little one or not.
Little one or not. Anyone else got a better word than little nose? What's the trope we're seeing again and again?
Button.
Thank you. Okay, excellent. So, anybody have anything that they'd like to add to that before we...
Clothing.
Yeah, we had hair accessories.
We had like any kind of headgear, like, you know, like
I think
flower
we said,
or whatever.
Yeah, I think if we sort of take something like a flower in the hair as being part of the hair, but that's a good point. Hair longer, and I'm just going to put down here flowers, bows, etc. Okay, so that's quite common. And then none of you came up with any non-visuals, so we're going to put clothing. Now, the problem with clothing is that in some cases the character doesn't have clothing. So if you have an anthropomorphized character or a highly stylized character, the clothing isn't a giveaway, and that's where we have to revert to things like eyelashes. So Mrs. Pac-Man is a good example. You know, she has a bow and she has eyelashes, so that we can tell the difference. So that, I forgot to put on, but when this slide comes up, it's that we want to just sort of talk about it and get some feedback. So this is the feedback. Any comments on that slide before I move on? In the context of the session?
They're all blokes.
Are they?
Yeah.
The one with the blue speech belt looks like it has eyelashes a little bit, they're a pretty woman.
They're all blokes.
Yeah.
Why are they all blokes?
Because they've got big noses, they've got button noses, and they're not wearing their hats.
Because they're all talking over one another.
I would argue.
You're not saying anything.
No. I'm just going to back off. I would say that actually they're probably gender neutral and we have read them as men.
No, there is one woman there.
This is one with the mouth closed.
Quite. The mouth closed, yeah.
Okay, let's. Can we steer clear of this political minefield and go into. Right, so what I've done is I've picked a range of characters and I've deliberately tried to pick characters from a number of eras, and I've tried to pick characters that would not necessarily be the canon. You understand what the canon of thought means. If I said to you, feminist architecture in Bristol, there are three people in the canon. Does that make sense? Okay, the canon is basically when you begin to discuss a particular area of practice, a particular area of expertise, names jump up. So if I said to you, Sandon Glass, who would be the first person in the canon that you could think of? An artist who works with Sandon Glass. Oh my god, Chris. he does, he's just being bold. Caroline Leaf would be the person that, if I said to you, studios that work with plasticine, Aardman is the first one in the canon. So it's the first ball that gets fired out of the canon when this conversation comes up. So I've deliberately steered clear of Betty Boops and Frozen and things like that, because I wanted to just talk about coding very quickly. So I was hoping that you would come up with pretty much what you've come up with, so well done you guys. If we look around, we have characters like Lady, is she Gwendolyn? No, she's not Gwendolyn.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Yes.
She's not, Gwendolyn's the other one. We can't remember her name. Tottington, Lady Tottington, thank you. The name itself, Tottington, she's Totting. Eyelashes, flowering hair, red lips. She's considerably slimmer than the male characters in the film. Not always the case with Aardman, because Gwendolyn is almost exactly the same size and shape as Wallace in the in A Close Shave, but she's a different trope. So what we're looking at here is tropes. Anybody tell me what the word trope means?
Specific characteristics.
It's particular to TV and movies.
Like
so,
a recurring device?
Exactly. Device is an excellent word. It's a recurring narrative strategy or visual strategy to shorthand the story. So a trope in TV would be the femme fatale. So she walked in with legs up to here. We instantly know who that character is. We know who that is. So we're looking at a number of tropes, but what I'm actually interested in is how these have been presented to us. So a lot of these are publicity stills. So these aren't from films necessarily. I think Tottington is because I couldn't find one, but a lot of these are publicity stills. And I'm interested in the attitude of the characters. So what are the characters displaying?
Curves?
Flesh.
Naivety.
Who said naivety? Which character do you think is naivety?
It's
a trope. It tells us, but what I thought was really interesting was, with the possible exception of the top two on the right, they're almost all in the same pose. So it's a trope. This isn't, and I could have put another 20 on here. Okay, so there's a lot of female characters that when they're posed, are posed in a certain way. It's a visual cue. It tells us more than they are female. So we know Miss Piggy's female by looking at her, because we read all of the things that we discuss. We read the hair. We read the eyelashes. But we now know something more about her because of the way she's positioned. So what else could you read into that character or that character? Well, actually, that one, she's probably slightly different. What?
That they're feminine.
That they're feminine. That they're
perhaps girly.
Girly, yeah. Elegant.
You can immediately read that Miss Piggy as opposed to a character from Cloudy the Transparent Horse is materialistic.
So there's a certain glamour, a certain materialistic. What about the notion of availability? And I know, Chris, you're laughing, but.
Available.
Oh, this pig is available now.
Spoilers.
Characters who know they're attractive.
Thank you. That's excellent. That, say that again.
Characters who know they're attractive.
Exactly. What do we know about every single one of these? None of them are being shy. They might be pretending to be shy, but there's a I'm attractive. Piggy, that is the joke with Piggy, is that she isn't, or that she's a lot less attractive than she thinks she is. But that's just something as simple as attitude. And these are just stills. When these things start to move, every character can tell you so much more about themselves by how they move. So if they can tell you that much by how they're posed, once these things start moving.
I would also say on that last slide there, that there seems to be a willingness on their part to be sexualized.
Thank you. That's an excellent point. They're not, with the exception of Smurfette, who maybe is being slightly...
No? She knows what she's doing. And the middle top as well.
Princess.
Whoever.
Jen. Anyone? Battle of the Planets? No?
Yeah. She wasn't alone.
I wanted to be her when I grew up. You can see I obviously succeeded. Okay. So again, we're just before we come off the subject of coding, quite a lot of the time the coding, as Tom pointed out earlier, was to make them different to the male. Okay, so it was to sort of set them apart. And I think you can, to an extent, you can buy into that, but you always need to dig a little bit deeper. You always need to look at the coding of a character, and it's male or female, in relation to their part within the narrative. So if we look at the characters, we start with Mickey and Minnie. Does anybody know anything about the character design of Minnie when it was decided that Mickey needed a girlfriend, wife, love interest? No, no one has done any reading on it. Okay, this is quite a vintage. She's been up-styled for more contemporary audiences. But one of the things that gets discussed quite a lot in conversations about gender is Minnie and her knickers. That it was decided that by allowing her to reveal her underwear, this would make her more cute. Now again, we have to remember that these cartoons, this was in its infancy, they weren't necessarily for children. So the idea of having visible underwear, if you look at Betty Boop, if you look at other female characters, that was quite acceptable. It was about being cute. It was about being attractive or being available or being whatever, but the idea of having a skirt short enough. If you walked down the street at those times with your underwear showing, you probably would have got arrested. So it was quite risque at the time. Very, very heavily coded. If you took her eyelashes off, in fact, if you stripped both of them naked and took her eyelashes off, there's only one other difference between them. So if you take all their clothes off and she gets her eyelashes trimmed, not even about pose, so yeah, the pose is different there, but if they were posed exactly the same, there is, and it's a very subtle difference, but it's quite key to one of the points we're going to bring up next.
Is it something to do with the mouth shape?
Yes, yeah.
Slightly smaller.
Okay, yeah. Anyone offer up a reason as to why the female character would have a slightly smaller mouth? It could well be. It could, given that when it was written, it could well be that they have less to say. But there's something else that we're going to pick up on. You've already picked up on it.
I think it's just because of the anatomical features. Generally, men have
bigger mouths.
So
it could be just about the anatomical features, which I think is a very valid point. One other thing.
Well, it's the lipstick thing is not seen there, but like every other character, pretty much other than the Arden examples, have that their mouth is smaller,
yeah.
But they're also wearing makeup.
Yeah. So the mouth is smaller, they're wearing makeup. So can anyone make a connection? One, there's a very important thing about a small mouth.
They don't talk.
It's not that they don't talk, it's a visual thing. Okay?
It's
so
kissable.
It's kissable. So when you say it's kissable, what do we mean by that? It makes the character more
attractive.
A small mouth with large eyes equals what?
Infantile,
childish. Female characters have large eyes and small mouths to make them flirty, baby-like.
Okay, so these are not, this isn't my opinion. I'm going to come on to some scholarly articles that discuss this. There is a very disturbing connection between the tropes that are used in female character representation and infantilism, I can never say it right, a sort of an obsession with, you know, very, very young females, basically. So it comes from a deep and dark place. Before we move on, Fred and Wilma, we talked about coding. We looked at these guys. There's another code that some of these guys have, and it's weird, but it's pearls. And again, I sort of haven't been able to find any, I've researched and researched and researched, I haven't been able to find any writing on the subject, but I have some ideas. We're going to come on to it in a minute. We talked a little bit about established TV tropes. Anybody know who these are?
Honeymoon.
The honeymooner. So what's he about to say to her, right there in that shot? Do you know that line?
Straight to the moon.
Right, and what does that mean?
He's
good at this. Yeah, so the honeymooners were the kind of the character comedy of their day. So it's Jackie Gleason. Oh, not terrible, I can't remember her name.
There was different actresses.
Different actresses, yeah. And the big running joke was she would say something, smart mouth, and he would go, one of these days I'll let's ride to the moon, which meant one of these days I'm going to hit you so hard you're going to hit the moon. Again, this was made in the 1930s, 20s and 30s, different era, different time. But I think a lot of the coding of the pearls actually comes from this established trope. And there's things like I Love Lucy and film of the time where it wasn't just female, it was a certain type of female. It was that domestic, sort of middle to upper middle class married couple. Pearls was a sign of affluence.
And I would love to say that I think the same thing can be said about Jackie Gleason in terms of him being the sort of blue collar
exactly.
Big guy.
Yeah.
Because that's now these. You just see it with Fred, but you see it with every sort of nuclear family sitcom, certainly.
Yeah, it's a trope, and where you don't see it is where they're deliberately trying to subvert the trope,
yeah.
So they're trying to update or modernize the idea. So the notion of tropes I've put in there to say that you've always got to look to live action, you've always got to look to literature, you've got to look to TV and film when you're starting to analyze. Specifically, if you're looking at examples from certain times, so you look at films, you look at the dominant form, which is filmmaking, TV, advertising. Advertising is fantastic. If you're trying to trace a line of something visual or a trope through into animation, if you look at the adverts of the day, they give you a lot more information because they're short. They have to communicate much faster than a film. So the visual things in advertising happen to communicate really, really quickly. So audiences nowadays, so we're moving forward now, we're looking at nowadays, and we're looking at us as audiences, we're looking at our potential audiences when we're making films for public consumption now, 2 years' time, 10 years' time. Audiences are becoming much more aware of tropes. Anyone here have watched Community? Yeah? If you haven't watched Community as an animator, I think you have to watch Community. Community is a series, an American series, but it's incredibly meta in that it sort of draws, you know, circles within circles within circles that break the fourth wall. They play with the notion of tropes, and they have two episodes that are entirely animated, which the entire episode is a fantastic pastiche of how those animations happen. One is a holiday special Christmas claymation, and the other one is a G.I. Joe sort of toy advert turned, and they absolutely represent the time and the place that they were made. So we're talking about audiences becoming more aware of tropes in media and film, and of diversity in general. We are far more enlightened now than the MA group was 10 years ago, and I'm one of the first, I am from the very first MA group, and I can tell you that there's a lot more literature, there's a lot more out there now that's showing a shift, that these tropes are starting to be, not abandoned, but questioned. Character design has begun to recognize, so character designers, filmmakers, directors, are recognizing and somewhat broadening the narrow definition of female shape, form, and convention. So moving from very coded females, we're starting to have female narratives, or females within, and again, I'm looking very specifically here at feature, and very mainstream animated series. I'm not looking at short form or children in any great detail. but scratch the surface. And what my point here is we're not quite there, because if you scratch the surface between these altered narratives, it is still very difficult to identify a lead female character with agency beyond the desires and needs of the male lead. Okay, so while you may have characters where you have, it's a female-led film, you need to think about it. Is it a female-led film? Is the female, does the female have total agency over the desires of another character? And are they free of those tropes? So can we have a film that is led by a female where you could change the gender of the character and nothing else would have to change in the story? So I would, if what I would really like to do is sometime in May, run this session again, but run it looking at male characters, and I would ask the same question. But can we think, and I am going to come back to this in a minute, but can we think of a film where the female character can be taken out, a male character? So if the character just happens to be female, there's nothing narratively important about how it looks, how long its eyelashes are, it's an arbitrary decision.
Probably quite a lot of Japanese anime.
And I'm really glad you said that. That was something I meant to say. I have very little knowledge on Japanese anime. It is not within my subject area, but possibly if I were to develop this lecture in terms of male character, I would be looking at superheroes, I would probably be looking at anime, and looking at the female characters in anime just as much as the male. Yeah?
Like a lot of the Ghibli films, the ones made by Miyazaki in particular,
yeah.
Brings like a really big focus on sort of like female characters.
They're usually quite young, aren't they? They're usually...
They have a tendency to be, but not always.
Are they pre-sexual? That's the point. Or would they? Would...
Some are and some aren't.
Yeah. Because the point here is where films can said to be female-led, character design doesn't deviate far. So even where it's a female-led film, you quite often have the character that needs to be cute. It needs to have certain codes. Coraline is a really good example. You could change Coraline to a male. The relationship would have to become about his relationship with his mother rather than her relationship with the mother. But it wouldn't change the story that much. It tends to be, if the character is younger, these lines become more blurred. So at the point where a character is you know, can be sort of safely sexualized, you know, we're not even going to get into when that is, things become a little trickier and a little harder to support. What we are now entering into is an era where you have a much higher proportion of female writers, producers, and directors in independent and short form. So one of the reasons why these debates have started to happen in the last 10 years is because the industry is opening up. You are having a lot more women graduating from animation, a lot more women entering into the industry. That's been happening for 20 years, but those women have now worked their way up. So it's not just that suddenly women are entering the industry, it's that they have had a much, much more permanent presence and worked their way through. So you now are starting to have a generation of female character designers, directors, who are actually out there working on feature, working on stuff that is mass consumption, so everybody is seeing their work. A higher proportion in independent and short form. Independent and short form is a whole other conversation because it's not commercially driven. It's a much smaller audience, and it tends to be an audience of filmmakers or people who are very appreciative of the form. Therefore, they're not constrained by the same sort of commercial imperatives that you would have in feature. So they can afford to have a slightly ugly character. It's not going to lose the money. And that's a really important thing to think about. This isn't about people being unenlightened or uneducated or unsympathetic. It's a business, and you have to appeal. And if the market wants pretty preteen characters with button noses and red lips, who are we to deny them that? Because at the end of the day, we need to put food on our plates, we need to feed our children, we need to pay our mortgages. So, a higher proportion, I've read that. I've said that few feature-length and widely broadcast films exist. Even with short form, short films, I was trying to find films that you could say had a male and female character that, you know, relationship that wasn't about girlfriend, boyfriend, or sexual attraction, or any sort of sexuality. And I've Mary Max. Again, it's a child. So quite a lot of the time when you find a film that actually starts to break out, it's slightly safe. Yeah?
I think in Frozen you can change Elsa.
and it wouldn't make a difference. And in fact, the book that it was based on, it was
a really good point, yeah. So we're talking about Frozen and changing the character of Elsa. The only thing I would say is that that film has been very much put forward as a relationship between sisters. So it would change it slightly because it would really be brother and sister. But Frozen is a good example of where people have consciously tried to break the trope and consciously tried to break the mold slightly. I put in Max and Mary. I put in Peter and the Wolf, and that's a very tenuous one. But we know that the duck is female in Peter and the Wolf. We know this because the duck in the original is in an opera. It was called Sasha. So there you go. So I put that in to say there's an example of a character. Could be male or female. Just so happens to be female, but no eyelashes, no red lips, no knickers. This is far more scope in short film, so we looked at something like Madame Totley-Potley, and I don't know, actually we didn't, I did with the level three. But very, very different set of conventions and breaks all sorts of boundaries and molds. But I would still say that blurring of the notions of gender and sexuality make it difficult to place a leading female character in a film that doesn't expressly deal with female-centric subjects. Okay, and Madame Totley-Potley is very much about sexuality, female sexuality. There's lots and lots and lots of themes to it. So we're going to be taking a break in about 10 minutes. So I'm going to just really quickly whiz through something that I wanted to talk to you about. One of the things that actually put all of the previous slides together for me, one of the reasons I chose all of the previous slides, is I did a kind of a literature review. I decided I wanted to look at some aspect of a gender, and I went through journals, newspaper articles over the last couple of weeks to see what was in the news. And it's a good way of kind of taking the temperature, so you see what debates are quite kind of open. So does anybody here have a particular journal or a particular online source that they go to pick up news about animation?
Cartoon Brew.
Squiggly.
Animation World.
Network. Really, really good. I've got all three of them in here. So it's not just animation. Sometimes if it's quite a big story, you'll get it in mainstream newspapers. So first thing was Inside Out wins Pixar's 8th Oscar. And that basically set a flurry of articles in motion. So around Oscars is always a good time to gather some good quotes and some good information from makers of films because they're in the spotlight. So there's a lot of Inside Out is a universal tale with a feminist kick. Has anybody seen Inside Out? Yeah, most of you have seen it. We won't do any spoilers. It tackles depression, but it fails to address veiled sexism. Pixar fails at body positivity in Inside Out. Again, we're going to get to that. So these are the silhouettes of the characters from Inside Out. So what, in your opinion, could have sparked some of these comments?
Joy and all scum.
Sorry, Laura Bess, sorry.
Just joys and disgust silhouette.
So, in silhouette.
They both have hourglass figures, but sadness doesn't.
Okay, so it doesn't necessarily have an hourglass figure, but.
Is that the sad one, though?
Yeah, this is the sad one here. Yeah?
They all still look very much the same, the female characters, whereas fear and anger look very, very different.
Did you read the article?
No.
Oh, well spotted.
Could we say that body positive, because joy is nice and slim and sad is a little bit fat.
Yeah. Whereas anger is very square and male.
Square and male?
Square. Well, he's broad-chested. Yes.
So they're quite unique shapes, then. They're like really, not really human shapes.
Okay, so what can we say about the character design? And you're in the right ballpark that would have possibly sparked some of this backlash in the media. So, I think your point was absolutely excellent, that they look human.
It's easier to identify, like I mentioned now, that the anger silhouette is a male one, compared to the figure, more figurative human anatomy is the female.
In maybe a sense, you know, joy and sadness have a lot more to do in terms of weightlifting the story than anger or fear. So you generally find protagonists are more normal, and it's the more side characters that have the crazy design. So, up as an example, Doug is kind of normal because he's important for the story, but Kevin is wacky because he's not actually that important. And I think that's partially
so it, it could be part of the trope of animation. And Kevin is a female. So, it, you know, you can, as I said, you can always find examples where the opposite is true, but...
But still, at the same time, out of the five characters there, three of them are female, and all three females look more...
And that's absolutely spot on. They could be from two different films. And, yeah, sorry.
That's like Redo when I watched the film, is that the three female emotions were more prominent on Riley's life? And that's why they were female?
Yeah.
That's what I'm
trying to say. Yeah, no, so that they're, the choice of them being female and which emotions they represent isn't what we're discussing, but it's a very good point.
Also, when you look inside the heads of the other characters, they're all whatever gender they are.
Yeah.
It's only before before puberty, the trope is that they are, even though they sort of look gender specific, they are meant to be gender neutral. Yeah. And then as soon as they decide what they are, they become masculine. So all the dad characters, even though they're exactly the same as
the
women all have the same haircut.
Yeah, excellent point. Back to hair.
Yeah, I was just going to say, when you look inside the mum's head, anger, her anger and fear have the same body shapes, but they've got hair and eyelashes and lipstick. So
again, it's not that something is wrong or right. We're not judging here. I'm just questioning some of these. And I would suggest that, you know, reading these articles helps, because what you get is you get... input from designers, character designers, in some cases characters that are able to change their character because their original idea was rejected by the studio, a backlash from the studio explaining why. So there's it's a highly complex issue. This is the second one, and we're going to just finish up with this and then take a coffee break. So this is the other piece of animation that I found very prevalent in the news. Zootopia, has anyone seen the trailers and stuff?
Just the trailers,
yeah, obviously it's not out yet. And again, quite a high proportion of articles are either about how it was made and exciting new techniques in Maya, or they're about this. So the reason I'm doing this news review with you guys is to say this lecture isn't because Mary wanted to talk to you about gender. This lecture is because this is a really important issue for you guys. You are the designers, you are the script writers, you are the reviewers, you are the teachers of the next 20 years. And things are changing. And they are changing very slowly, but if we can get you guys to recognize these changes, it's actually going to place you in a good position going into industry. And it's not necessarily, oh, you'll get hired if you... But if you can discuss these things with a level of intellectualism, if you can actually see behind the visual, say, oh, this is cute, oh, she's got long eyelashes because she needs to be cute, you're placing yourself in a much better position to make content of worth. You're questioning things, or you're helping to change things. You're helping to improve things. So if we just move on to this, I'm just going to show you, I'm not going to read through here, but I put onto here links to these articles, some of these articles. And most of these articles have further links to lots and lots of others. So if you just click on the logo there, and then I just put up some quotes, and these are quotes that I want to pick up when we come back from break. So historically speaking, animated female characters are really, really difficult because they have to go through this range of emotions, but you have to keep them pretty. And they're very sensitive to, and then he breaks off, you can get them off a model very quickly. So this is Lino Di Salvio, head of animation on Frozen, and we were talking about Frozen earlier, and this was about the backlash to do with the shape of the characters' faces and what we talked about, the button nose. Part of his argument was it's a pragmatic decision because it's about the animation, and you have to take those conversations and you have to take that balanced view that sometimes it is pragmatic. I would argue that it's possibly a self-fulfilling prophecy that we have to keep them pretty. Well, what's pretty? And why do certain things, why are they recognized as pretty? And this is what I'm going to leave you on before we go for break. So every female face in recent Disney and Pixar movies looks the same. Has everybody heard something about this or read something about this?
I mean, it's not just Disney.
It's not just Disney, no, but this is this particular article. So, sorry, where I put a logo, that's not my words, it's from it's a quote from an article. If you click on the logo, you'll get to the article. Has anyone seen this?
Yeah.
Yeah, so this is a kind of proof, if you will. I would be careful with things like this because you can so easily select the characters that do this and just not select the ones that don't. But it's a good exercise. So what they've done is they've traced over the basic shapes of the same number of characters from two different films to highlight the variety in what is a marketable, because that's the bottom line, what is a marketable and acceptable male face feature, animated feature, and what apparently is a marketable and acceptable lead female face. And that's the important thing, that they've picked the, maybe not the lead character, but they're not secondary or tertiary characters, they're characters that are part of the story and the narrative. Okay. And then this is the very last one, Brave creator blasts Disney for blatant sexism in Princess Makeover. That's a really interesting article to read through, but it's about how the woman who designed Merida had responded and reacted when this was a publicity still, it was a pre-publicity still where they gave her a vamp to make her look more like a Disney princess, and it created a huge backlash. Did Disney do this because they wanted to infantilize or sexualize Merida?
No.
So why did they do it?
To sell more dolls.
To sell more dolls. So what were they making her look more like?
Everything.
Which is their brand. So again, you have to think pragmatically, you have to think. So it's a balanced view. There are reasons why you can have a very, very kind of emotional response to this. And obviously the lady who designed it, God love her, designed it around her 13-year-old daughter. So this looks like her 13-year-old daughter. To see that happen to your 13-year-old daughter is obviously going to be quite upsetting. That's just another article, we'll go through that. And just, that's where I wanted to stop. And I want to just show you a little bit of film. We're just about coming up to break time. But I have been going through all of these slides and doing all this research and all of the time asking my friends, most of whom are sort of ex-graduates from this course, my animator friends, to come up with a female character who could actually just be made male and the story wouldn't have to change in any way. The only one that I could genuinely think of was Dory. So what I'd like you to do is we're going to watch this, we're going to look at what we've got going on here and see how many of these visual codes Dory actually has. And does it take away from Dory's character? Is Dory less appealing because she doesn't have any of these?
Oh, you quit it?
What?
Try to swim here. What, ocean big enough for you or something like that?
Huh?
You have a problem, buddy? Huh? Huh? Do you?
You want to piss me?
Yeah.
Ooh, I'm scared now.
What? Stop following me, okay?
What are you talking about? You're showing me which way the boat went.
A boat? Hey, I've seen a boat that passed by not too long ago. It went.
Wait,
this way? Yeah, but this way. Follow me?
Wait a minute. What is going on? You already told me which way the boat was going.
I did? Oh, no.
If this is some kind of practical joke, it's not funny. And I know funny. I'm a clownfish.
No, it's not. I know it's not. I'm so sorry. See, I suffer from short-term memory loss.
Short-term memory loss? I don't believe this.
No, it's true. I forget things almost instantly. It runs in my family. Well, I mean, at least I think it does.
Okay. So, sorry. We're going to take that one. Right. We'll come back to this. We're going to take a break now. It's exactly 3 o'clock. My God, I'm good. I'm going to give you a good half hour on the understanding that part of your break, we're going to come back to this, is I want you to just start to chat and start to think about task two. Task two is going to be the last hour of the session. Working in groups, I want you to produce three separate versions of the same simple character. So you can decide on the tables which character. It could be one of the ones that you've already presented, or it could be something you decide on. And what I'd like you to do is I'd like you to draw it, and it can be all of you contributing to the drawing, or it can be one person doing one thing, one person doing another. Strong masculine male, shy pretty female, or an easy? Ooh, paging Dr. Freud. An evil, sexy femme fatale. And I want you to use every trope, I want you to use every code and every signifier, on the understanding that none of us are going to become offended. So can we make that decision now that none of us, and males and females, because there's a male character in there. So what I'd like you to do is to actually make every Mr. Chris is looking so gleeful right now. Is everybody happy? Does anybody feel uncomfortable about this? Everyone's happy to, if you feel, I don't want to be sort of doing something that's highly sexualized, you could add a fourth character in there and do it as a preteen for a children's television or something like that. So if there's four of you on the table, you can either pick another, you can add one of your choice, or one of you could do it for children's TV, or you could, I don't mind. Okay? So if we disappear now, so we're back on, sorry Chris, yeah?
I won't be joining you after the break, I'm afraid, so I won't be able to do the...
Could you do it at home and put it in
the what I would like to say before I go, I would just like to reiterate, as an animation tutor, one thing you picked up on, I thought was really good, about students, and it's not just at your level, I think it's all animation students, well, all students studying anything, about their engagement with their practice should extend beyond, as you said there, the practicalities of the craft, but that you should be engaging with your practice on an intellectual level. I'm forever going on about that in terms of drawing, but I think you're absolutely right, and that is why this session is so, so vital.
Good.
It's not about employment, it's about that you engage with your practice on a completely different level.
It's about you being smart and you sounding smart. Okay, we'll say half an hour, so if you're back here by sort of between 2:30 and 1:25, please be on time, we're going to go straight in, we've got a lot to get through. Is there anybody who cannot stay until 5 besides Chris? Is everyone else able to stay till 5?
Mm-hmm.
Brilliant. So have a think about that, have a chat, back up, please don't bring coffee back into the room when you come back up, and I'll see you in a little while. Have a lovely break, and I'm going to finish off what I'm going to do.
That was yesterday.
Oh,
no. No, I was thinking.
Was it Benson? I was like, what day is it?
I'll let you know what the
I drew this because I saw yours. But that's fancy. So gender neutral.
I don't have a key for this. Remember I take it as well, they're more likely to steal the cameras than the bikes. Yeah. Thank you guys for contributing, you're brilliant.
That's alright, I mean, it was this is really, really interesting because I was reading off about this a couple of weeks ago about Steven Universe.
Yes.
Brilliant example because you've got a very typically feminine character because she's got tiny waist, large chest and large hips, and then you've got a short, fat, stumpy one, and then you've got a tall, thin one with a long nose and no eyes, she wants to have, and it's fantastic, and there are other characters as
What's really interesting is to look at what's being written about the characters and to see who's writing it, because you get a completely different view.
It's so weird, because when I was reading the article, a lot of the comments were from girls saying, I love this character because she looks like me, I love this character because she acts like me, I love this character because she looks and acts like me, and everyone was like, well, you could literally replace Stephen, the main character, with a girl, and it wouldn't matter.
This is
the only defining feature is that he's the only male of the species that these female characters come from. Which is what sets them apart. You could easily.
Is there a particular link on YouTube or something that kind of shows the characters
individually? Yeah. You can always look at the YouTube channel.
I was going to say I might because what I was going to do, what I've done is this is all on Blackboard, but I did it on adaptive release because I didn't want anybody reading it before because it would have skewed the results of the survey. But I might just add in some links to some of the the films that you guys have mentioned. So would you remind me before we finish
absolutely.
To just write them down on the whiteboard so that I can go away and put them
together? I think what we have to do is just type in Steven Universe into YouTube. And I think there's one particular channel that just posts clips constantly.
Yeah.
But yeah.
I have to be so careful because all I want to do is get into narrative and things. You get into narrative and then you are into feminist theory. You are into all these things.
I'm literally just going to pop down, get some.
Anyway, go grab a coffee. I need a coffee so desperately.
And then you get your food together, coming back up.
So. Oh, are you going? You're staying.
Just go for a walk. I'm
you would be all alone.
You're
going to
be next. I'm really
good. Thank you for your contributions. You've got some very, very valid points there.
Thank you. And also, thanks. Sorry, I don't know.
You need strong.
No.
This is
a
really intriguing subject, and I'm so glad that you're talking about this.
Oh, thank you. Are you enjoying it?
I am really enjoying it.
Do you know how restrained I've had to be? Because I actually had the 60 slides altogether, and I sat down last night and I had 120 slides because there's just so many interesting things.
Could you kind of do almost like the very extended cut version? Could like you make the 60 slides available?
Oh, these are going to be available. These are already on Blackboard. As a PowerPoint with all the links, but I put it on adaptive release because I didn't want anybody looking at it before you do the.
Yeah.
That's why there was a lot of mystery shrouding around the. Because if you knew it was about gender, I wouldn't have got such good results. I think it's going to come up tomorrow because I think I put it so that it comes on tomorrow and I have to add one or two links in. But what I want to do is maybe just get some ideas from you guys, write them down, and I'm going to put those links into it as well so that you have it all. I think it might be really interesting. I'm going to ask Chris if I could, after your assignments, if I could come in and do the same session again, but about male.
Yeah, that
which
would
I think
be
really,
really
interesting.
I'd love to.
And then I can be a bit more open and get some things from you before the session the next time, because the cat's out of the bag now. So. I'm going to leg it to get some tea, so I'll see you back up here. Yeah?
Yeah.
Is that playing back or everything?
No, Mary has a microphone and I can hear
Oh my god. A British company has declared that it will allow women to take days off during their period.
Holy shit, who are they?
And it might be regarded as a sick day.
I'm applying to them tomorrow.
Yeah, because like, oh, that's so so cool because they recognize, like, for some people, it like causally absolutely debilitating.
You did. Got all the way down and realized I'd left my card.
No, I'm not good.
you see any of this.
No.
You probably didn't know, but Bunny can call another bunny cute, but when other animals do it, it's a little...
Are they like making a reference to the whole England today? We're going to discuss this.
That everyone thinks it's just a flabby donut-loving cop stereotyping you. Oh.
It's okay. You've actually got... But there's a...
What?
In your neck, the fold... What? The...
There's... Oh, you wacky little chickens? Oh.
That's your roll call. So, which way do I...
Oh, bullpen's over there to the left.
Great. Thank you.
Oh, that poor little Ben's going to give me a lie.
I'll take it in the last one.
How did they change the name of it in the UK? It's called Zootropolis or something.
I think the name is weird, but I think it's supposed to be sort of a hark back to Metropolis, you know, the 1930s, the thing that they run the life, it's like. I'm having a bit on.
Look like a
bear.
Discussed. Make sure Riley stands out today, but also blends in. When I'm through, Riley will look so good, the other kids will look at their own outfits and bark. Joy.
Yes, Joy?
You'll be in charge of the console, keeping Riley happy all day long.
And may I add, I love your dress. It's adorable. Oh, this old thing. Thank you so much. I love the way it grows.
Train o'clock. Right on schedule. Anger. Unload the daydreams. I ordered extra in case things get slow in class.
Might come in handy. If this new school is full of boring, useless classes, which it probably will be.
Oh, Sadness, I have a super important job just for you.
Really?
Mm-hmm. Follow me. Hands there. Perfect. This is the circle of sadness. Your job is to make sure that all the sadness stays inside of it.
Hey,
it's not my place to tell you how to do your job. Just make sure that all the sadness stays in the circle.
See?
You're a pro at this. Isn't this fun?
No.
All right, everyone, freshen up. We are going to have a good day, which will turn into a good week, which will turn into a good year, which turns into a good life.
So, big day, new school, new friends, huh?
I know. I'm kind of nervous, but I'm mostly excited. How's everyone? You look at her?
Very cute. You going to be okay? You want us to walk with you?
Mom and Dad, with us in public? No, thank you.
Yep, I'm on it.
Nope, I'm fine. Bye, Mom. Bye, Dad.
Have a good day at school, monkey.
Have a great day, sweetie.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to play that in relation to, I played a little bit of Zootopia just before, so maybe I'll put that back on again when we're doing the drawing task. Just a little short clip. Has anybody seen the clips? Has everybody seen the clips in Zootopia? Okay.
No.
It's something I want to discuss, but I want to get through a couple of points first. So, I scooted through a few points just before break, and just to go through again, the quote that's on the slide, you'll find the article if you click on the logo, so I'm going to put this on, this is already on Blackboard, but it's on adaptive release, so you won't see it till tomorrow, because, as I said to some of you, I didn't want you going ahead, because then you would have, it would have biased you in terms of the research exercise you did at the beginning. And this is sort of my conclusions about some of those articles and some of the topics that we've been discussing. And we talked about that there's a pragmatic reason why women's faces in animation need to be pretty. There's a pragmatic reason why we need to code for femininity. Actually, the top one is a quote from an article that I just particularly resonated with. And it says, DeSalvo's comments about women having to look pretty and having a limited range of expression are not inherent rules within animation. They are arbitrary aesthetic choices. And this is what I wanted to start the second part of the session with, is to say we all have our own agency to make choices when you are working on your own individual films. For some of us, some very fortunate among us, we may be in a position in 5 years or 2 years or 10 years to be making our own film with no financial constraints. So you may win a bursary, you may receive funding, and you're not necessarily then having to, you're making the film for exposure, you're making the film to add to your form, to add to your craft, and to the broader sort of animation world. You're not necessarily having to make revenue from that film. That's very much independent film. But if we look at, again, the dominant form, which is animated feature and, you know, very, very populist short form, people make choices. And we have to be careful that we do not rationalize our choice. So saying, oh yes, but Red Lips, it's just a code, don't worry about it, it's fine. It's just a code. It just means the battery's gone. Could you just hit the top button for me there? That should stop. Yeah, cool. You can relax now, you're not on camera anymore. These are choices, and there's a reason why, and we have had generation after generation after generation of people defending those choices, and it isn't necessarily about gender. There's a much broader debate about, you know, animation for children and the notions of sexuality and Disney princesses. I'm very proud of the fact that, with the exception of Merida, I don't have Disney princesses in here, because that's the default knee-jerk when you talk about gender in animation, because it's the one where it's almost safe, because it's children's form, and it's such old hacky ground, and also, oh, but we fixed it. Look, we have Tangled, we have Brave, we fixed it. Feature animators choose to use a recycled palette of expression for women. Oh, women don't need as much, they don't have as much expression, and women don't need a firm jaw, women don't need to have a very strong featured face, because their contribution is softer. Somebody used that expression earlier, it's a softer. Bollocks, is it softer? That's something that we've all been conditioned to believe. And in real life, you don't experience that as much as your parents would have, or your grandparents would have. But we still believe in the tropes. We don't identify with those gender roles anymore for our personal lives, but for some reason in animation, we do. We still buy into those tropes. Why?
Money?
Money? No, why as consumers? Why are you, you know, there were a few cases today where we were almost defending. Oh, but it's done for this reason. Or why do we want to not read in things into animation as opposed to film or as opposed to live action TV? Why are we slightly more passive about these messages with animation?
Just, I'd yeah. say because it's considered like a sort of a more usually for a children's medium, and so like as adults then it's kind of like, oh well, it doesn't matter as much, it's not a real...
Okay, so it's a children's medium, so it's not real, but I would say you're absolutely on the right track. But as consumers, yep.
You were just going to say, it's when you compare animation to live action, it's, I don't know how to say, not real.
Yeah.
So
it's a constructed reality. Mm-hmm. So things can be placed. Now, TV is a constructed reality. We don't see the construction lines. We don't see the making process. The interface allows that to be hidden, whereas watching animation, you see the construction process. But there's another really big reason why it is difficult as an animator, as a student of animation, as an adult, to be critical of animation. When did you all probably watch more animation than you were? Yeah.
Maybe it's the way that we've learned that things are, and I mean, from a childhood, you know that, you know, female animation, creatures should behave like this, and we don't try to change it in the process because it's in our system. Some things become like symbols, something, and we're passing it on, and it continues and remains, say, not static, but no, it doesn't change very much.
Excellent point. Does anybody want to jump in on that point?
Well, there's this belief that men or toys will watch anything, not only watch. Films that have a male character and girls will watch anything.
Yeah.
So
they make more films for boys.
Yeah. I'll just come up to Thomas and then I'll come back to him. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know. Does it have anything to do with the fact that we were all exposed to animation as children?
That's I wanted somebody to make that point. I think it's very close that you said we watch it as children and it becomes part of our language, part of our learned heritage or our culture, because we consume the vast majority of our sort of animation form when we are maybe not children, but certainly in our formative years, we watched it as children.
Yeah, I was going to say something along the lines that we've been gradually conditioned into thinking that that's the way it should be,
yeah.
Because it's animated and not real, it's not a big issue.
And I think that's sort of the point that I wanted to pick up there. I've put these two quotes are from this particular article, and I've added it in there as a quote. But I wanted... We've had our talk, sorry, I keep forgetting to do the talky-talk. We've had our talky-talk, we've talked about Dory, I'm skipping ahead a tiny bit. I'm going to come back to this, we actually want to come on to this. So, we're just going to talk for another 10-15 minutes, and that gives us an hour to the final task and to look at our drawings and to analyse those. Does anybody have any questions or anything that they want clarified before we move on? Okay, excellent, cool. This is the last point, and this comes right back to what I started with when I set your aims. We talked about the contextualizing theory and practice. So we've looked at practice. We are going to look at our own practice in a very sort of microscopic way because it's very counterfeit to animate or to do a design in a two-hour session in an afternoon. But we're going to look at our own response to some of the ideas and some of the notions that have been kicking around today. But I wanted to sort of end the lecture part of today and the discussion part looking at theory. Quite often, and I think at master's level, the feeling is that you go and you read something and then you find a way of integrating it into your practice. You read something and then you change your practice to somehow reflect it. And it's a slightly upside down way of looking at theory. What should happen, and what does happen, and it will happen this semester in production more than last semester, is you will become curious, you will become interested, you will become maybe anxious, you will become motivated to read around a subject. And quite often, that itch can be scratched by reading articles, blog sites, opinions that are on the internet. Those are valid, those are important, but you must try to bring it back to theory. And you're not going to find a lot of theory just sort of randomly clicking around. You know the way you can get into a wormhole where you just click and click and click? All of that's quite interesting, and you're reading things that are interesting, but the advice that I would give you as an associate lecturer who has taught visual culture, who has taught animation, as a student who completed the course that you were on, is to try and be selective about finding some theory that roots some of that thought, or that either confirms or challenges something that you have previously thought. If it's not comfortable, that means that the structures of your mind are changing. You are adapting your understanding of your form. That has to happen at M level. You are all very immersed in the creative side of it. I'm sure you could all mention, 10 filmmakers off the top of your head that I've never heard of. There are areas in which you're very comfortable, and those are good and valid, and you hang on to those and you develop those, but you've got to start to readjust the sort of internal structures of your mind to take in established theory. So I'm just going to look at two particular theorists. And the first one is, I've said Richard C. King, C. Richard King et al., because it's, where's my book's gone? This book. And it's got about 10 different, it's essays, so it's about 10 different authors. And it's not in the library, but I have asked the library to stock it. But I got this on Amazon for, I think about £4.50 secondhand. So the secondhand section of Amazon, used and whatever it is. You can usually get really good textbooks that are ex-library books for half nothing. I've gotten some really good books for 99p. But that's an excellent one. I haven't quite finished reading it. I just read the two chapters on gender. But there's a lot of stuff in here about race. There's a lot of stuff in here about issues of representation. I don't agree with all of it, and you shouldn't agree. It's not about finding a theory that you agree with. It's about provoking some kind of a response. Has everybody know this book?
Yeah.
It's a bit jaded now, because this was written in 1998. So the examples, the illustrations, are quite often very remote, very obsolete. But he's bringing out a new version of this, and I think it's supposed to be out in April. It's about twice as thick, and one of the things he's done is he's massively updated the case studies. So I'm really looking forward to reading that. Wells writes exceptionally clearly and exceptionally well. So it's quite accessible reading. It's not, this is a little more film theory, it's a little denser. But this is actually quite easy to read. Again, I don't agree with everything Wells says, but it's a good touchstone, it's a good landmark to start to form my own opinion. Really, really excellent, but again, quite old, quite jaded. There's several copies of this in the library, and this one are on your reading list. So, you know, have a look, spend half an hour in the library, photocopy the odd page, start to read, and start to try and use some of the language here when you're critiquing or you're criticizing your own work. And then I've also said it doesn't have to be animation. There's a book here about digital dialectics, and it's about sort of digital narratives and the evolution of digital narratives. And there's a really good section on gender, and it touches on CG animation, virtual reality, motion capture, gaming. So again, you know, if you were particularly interested in Ghibli, if you're particularly interested in manga, there's a million books, there's a million articles out there. And the last thing I want to say is scholarly articles. If you do a search in Google for scholarly article on, you will get a wealth of PDFs that have been written by. And you have to be a little careful, because sometimes it could be an MA student, or it could be a PGC student, and it might be absolute rubbish. But if they've been published in Animation World Network or the Journal of Gender Studies, if it's been published in a reputable journal, they are well worth reading, because they're going to be very academically written, but they will touch upon some of this theory. Sorry.
I'm sorry, I was just going to say, you can specifically go on Google Scholar.
Thank you. There you go. I did have that in my head to say, and yes, thank you for saying that. Because Google Scholar is like going into images or videos. So you just get the scholarly articles. And the other thing is to share these with each other. So if you find something that maybe isn't that particularly interesting to you, but you think your classmate might be interested, reading doesn't have to be reading for absolute comprehension. You can skim, you can highlight. It's about starting to change those, as I said, those structures in your head. So King just talked about A Whole New World. He's got a chapter in Animating Difference called A Whole New World. And he talks about the manner in which individuals and institutions describe, interpret, and account for difference. Now, he's talking about race and gender. So he's talking about difference, diversity, in a much broader way. But he's saying that it is changing. Because it's 2011, this is a much more recent debate. It's a much more recent set of findings than Wells, which is 1998. So he's saying that institutions, so universities, Oscar committees, dare we say, reviewers, publishers, researchers, are interpreting the notion of difference. So it's not just that animation is changing, it's changing because the interpretations of diversity are changing. Overt expressions of sexism or gender bias have become taboo. So we go back to Minnie Mouse and her knickers, we go back to Betty Boop, we go back to... And I deliberately didn't put in all of those very racist and sexist animations from the 40s and the 30s, because I feel that's the knee-jerk when people talk about gender and animation, or we'll stick up Red Hot Riding Hood and Betty Boop and we'll have a lively discussion. And I think it's a diversion tactic. I think they're an illustration of a particular thing. But he's suggesting that they've become taboo. But they've been replaced by more covert and coded formulations. And this is what I was particularly interested in. So we say that Elsa, Lego, is strong, and she represents, and little girls love her, and oh, she's changed. No, she hasn't. What has happened is that feature has become very, very careful about how they choose to present. They're heavily coded, heavily sexualized women. So they're still coded, Elsa doesn't, you know, Elsa's not the same shape as I am. If there was a character that's the same shape as I am, it's either going to be an evil old witch or a comedy character. I don't particularly identify with either of those, but that's you know, my coding. Somebody else might be coded as, oh, because of their particular shape, they're always the hero, because it's someone who's tall. You never met Ian, but my colleague Ian, we did a session on this, and he was the absolute heroic proportions. And students would draw him, and we'd just say, just sketch Ian, and we'd draw him, and almost every single one, I'd say, in any kind of cartoon character you want. And I always wound up as people who started making me pretty, bless them, but students would draw me pretty and skinny, and I'd go, thank you, but I'm not that shape. And he would always have a superhero cape because his shoulders were wider than his hips and he was tall and he was big. So overt expressions of sexism have become taboo, but they are replaced by covert and coded formulations. Intention and humour, and this is something we can only touch upon, but this is something I'm very interested in. Explaining away, because, oh, it's just for the joke. It's just funny. Intention and humour are increasingly excused, narrowly or poorly represented groups. I am not of the opinion that, you know, Family Guy is, you know, I think you need humor to push agendas. You need humor to highlight. But I think that it is a very fine line between doing it in order to highlight diversity or to highlight racist attitudes towards Black Americans or sexist attitudes towards women in certain sections of society and using that as a cheap gimmick to get a laugh. And I don't have an answer. I'm not saying that I think it's, you know, one is right and one is wrong, but I think it's really good to recognise that it's increasingly things are being explained away to excuse narrowly or poorly represented groups and communities. Universalism and equivalence, and those are his words, bleed out the differences that make a difference. And that's a hard idea, that there's a whole maybe three pages on that, but we can sum that up by looking at Tarzan. Has everybody seen Tarzan? Mm-hmm. Okay, we're not going to discuss it in terms of gender. To just sort of turn our minds around a bit, we're going to discuss it in terms of race. Is Tarzan a racist film? Does it misrepresent any particular ethnic group?
Tarzan's been made white.
Sorry?
Tarzan's been made white.
Tarzan was white.
Oh.
He was Lord Greystoke.
Oh,
yeah. He's British. From, you know, his big period castle and his parents were white and he got lost in the jungle.
I can't remember, apart from obviously Tarzan, Jane, her father, and then the crew of hunters, were there any other characters
in it? I don't think there's any other.
They don't put any other. There are no humans. There are in the story, the original story, there are natives. Disney removed the natives so that they did not have to deal with the question of race. Now that's not racist, it's racist necessarily, but now if we think about gender, and we take our sexy, lithe little, you know, Elsa in her beautiful ice minx gown or whatever, and we say she somehow represents, she's strong, and maybe she is, maybe she isn't, but what they've done is they have removed the things that would have caused difficulty. So while she doesn't directly have agency, she's not directly linked to a male in the film, it's not about a romantic relationship, she's still highly sexualized, she's still highly coded. She's not Dory, is she? Okay, so these are, again, they're just points, they're just things to think about. Wells, and this is the last one we're going to talk about before we get on to the exercise, Wells has a chapter called, his whole chapter is called Gender in Animation, or Gender Issues in Animation. And his section on women is called Wayward Girls and Wicked Women. That is actually the name of a video that I think they probably have now updated to DVD in the library. So it was a Channel 4 VHS tape that was put out in about 1999, I think, maybe 2000. That was female filmmakers, specifically making films that they felt had feminine themes or sort of female-centric themes. Does anybody know Feet of Song? No? Joanna Quinn, Girls Night Out, so Girls Night Out is on there. Caroline Leaf, the Owl of Mary Goose, is on there. Black Dog is on there. I can't think of, do anyone think of that lady's name? These are all women who were independently producing films in the late 90s, early 2000s. They're all short form, so there's nothing feature, there's nothing series, it's all short form films. But they were films that were commissioned by Channel 4 in order to give a voice to female filmmakers. So he's sort of written this chapter very much in hand with this particular, so all of the films he talks about in this section, you can view on that DVD, but that you can go into YouTube and you can look at them all as well. He suggests that women have used animation to create a specific feminine aesthetic, and I put that in inverted commas because it's a quote from the that's what he says, feminine aesthetic, which resists the inherently masculine language of the dominant form. So his contention is that in order to have a voice in animation, women have to, female filmmakers, designers, animators, tend towards a type of animation that resists what he calls the dominant form. And if you read around it, he talks about comedy, he talks about slapstick humor, he talks about very action-based as being the dominant form and masculine, and then things like sand on glass, ink on glass, sort of much more experimental being the feminine form. So he believes that women have found this because it's less censored in its concerns, it's more subjective. So his contention is that women are kind of happier in that area because it's less subjective, they can be less narrative driven and they can look at themes more so than very strong narrative. He suggests that this allows independent filmmakers, female filmmakers, to address topics which male animators could not. So his entire chapter is saying that, you know, this is a place where female filmmakers can actually really make a difference. They can talk about political issues, they can talk about areas where they can go into exploring themes that male animators couldn't. And he then goes on to list sexual abuse, incest, murder, female desire, sexual confusion, rape, pregnancy, and social alienation. All I can say there is lucky us. Isn't that lovely? Sorry, that is my personal feelings coming through. That's the only time I was going to allow myself to get a little bit political. But this is written in 1998, and my response to this, I did my dissertation for my master's about gender and animation, and my response to this was, that is a compartmentalization of 51% of society. That is saying, yes, you can be a filmmaker, but it has to be independent film, and it can only, you really excel where you deal with the sorts of stories that men can't tell. So basically we get to do films about menstruation and childbirth. Again, lucky old us. And his contention is that the dominant form is masculine. Now I would flip that and say, at the time that he was writing, that was a rationalization. That was a, oh yeah, but it's easier to animate if the mouth is smaller on the woman. It's a rationalization. We can see that with the gift of hindsight. But in 10 years' time, we'll look back at the theories that are being written now. And the point of this is to say that it's a very easy 10, 15, 20 years down the line to come back and say, well, that's nonsense. We can do that because we can view it through a more enlightened lens. We are in a position where we are seeing female animators and directors and filmmakers entering into the dominant form and contributing quite well. They're still in the minority, but it was unheard of. The first female director to direct a feature-length CG film was, oh shoot, I can't remember her name, Kung Fu Panda 2. So, I'll look her up because I'll put it onto the PowerPoint before I post it up, but it's that recent, it's 4 years ago. So that was sort of the point I wanted to make there, and then we got on to here. So, working in groups, we've got about 20 minutes, 25 minutes for this. Some of you already started this, so what I'll do is when everyone gets stuck in, I've got some clips of some films that I'll just have playing in the background. So you can chat, you can talk to each other about it, but what we want to do is have time that every group can present their drawings. And I'd also like to take up the original exercise. Again, I'll leave them on the window, and if you want to take it away with you, you can. I'm hoping you don't, but And I might get some of those under the camera as well. So does anybody have any questions? Do you want me to just go through this again? What I'd like you to do for the next sort of half hour. No, we're all happy?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So, yeah.
Sorry, her name is Jennifer Yu.
Thank you. Jennifer?
Jennifer Yu. Well, Y-U-H.
I think she's Korean-American, isn't she?
She's, yeah, South Korean-born American director.
Yeah. Sorry, did you have your hand up? Oh, just doing a big stretch. Yeah? Yes, sorry, thank you. I have more paper over here. I was rationing it because I thought if I put it all out on the tables, knowing you guys, you do just tons and tons and tons of drawings and everything like that. So you can work on the big paper. Actually, no, can I ask that you work on the A4 because if we get it onto the visualizer, it just works better. Do you need more? Well, yeah, there's some different sheets there. The A3 you can use there, you can sketch on it and do longer if you want. And that's
a good gem. We're not supposed to work on
these. Right. Don't go back to those drawings.
I wanted to erase A3.
Sorry?
I didn't have A3 on me.
I just don't want you changing them, that's the only thing. Can I take those? Are you happy for me to take them?
Yeah.
If anyone does want them back, I'll just leave one of them so you might
for
through.
I had
them
at the last minute and then I remembered I wasn't supposed to.
But was it done before you knew what the exercise was about?
What, before?
Yeah, that's fine. Are you both happy for me to hang on to them?
Yeah.
Lynn, do you want to do this exercise? It's really quick.
Yeah.
It's going to be. I'll tell you what. I'll give you.
I mean, what?
There
he is. We already
established. They didn't know that
the
reflection
was going to be
like
gender.
So you're
supposed
to
be
a girl. So I don't know how useful it would be. I'm using it as a research device. I can't do this because you already know that it's about gender, but when you came out,
just
like, some of them actually have reference to gender.
Just the fact that it's questions everybody had when they were doing it.
In what way?
If, can I just ask, if you find that as you're doing this, you're feeling any tensions, there's things you're not going to tell. No, but this is part of the exercise. Could you jot them down? So things like, am I allowed to do this? Or if we did this, does it change?
Oh, one of those dresses.
That's what it's about. It's not about the character design. It's about the things that you have to think about.
And okay, yeah. So awkward questions were.
Yes,
that's not a problem. What time do you need to head?
No,
you head when you need to head. It's all going to be on Blackboard.
Okay, great.
So you can have a catch up. Hopefully, we'll get to do a little bit of the feedback before you go. If. I'm just saying if you finish, say in 10 minutes, you're going first, so that you get feedback on it before you go, that's all I'm saying, yeah.
He's doing the last one.
Well, it's quite useful, guys, is if there's questions, if there's thoughts, can I do this? Should I? If you could just jot down this team, where to have the same sort of tensions or little conflicts. I have to put a survey together.
Kennedy.
And it's going to be together, so I'm probably going to ask you guys to fill out the survey for me as well.
Okay.
One of the things is why people would default.
Yeah.
And okay, there's all these political ideas, but quite often it's actually just a slight squeamishness.
Yeah, that's again.
It's the women of them. The men generally don't have problem drawing. Kane's quote about because it's animation, you can change the world around.
That's the
issue, and I think that's why animation is sort of 10 years behind my
because
we can make the universe bend around the problem, not bend around the character, but bend around the problem. Or we can simply choose not to make gender an issue by gendering it as male by default. Which isn't a criticism, it's a very pragmatic way of doing it, but as long as that sustains, it's not going to change.
It's an interesting topic.
But I was just saying, sort of, I don't really get the fact that when I see people just like, oh, well, that's whatever. It's when they try and justify it.
Yeah.
Like I was saying about the whole, what was it? The Assassin's Creed issue.
Mm-hmm. I don't know that one, but I'm kind of familiar with
yeah, like, so we won't add a female model because it was so hard to animate. It was like, we have to do is get a male model, call it Becky or something,
yeah.
and just give her a code. But what they've done is, I think, in the newer game, they actually do have a female character, and she looks exactly the same, except they've given her a belt so you can see the hourglass figure.
I just, this is a game that has people as well as animating forces and stuff, and their excuse was, oh, there's no women in the game because it's too hard.
Yeah.
And it was a bit like, what are you even
what, the game is too hard to play? Or it's too hard to
it's
animate?
It's too hard to create and have an animatable woman character.
I think
I don't know, maybe they thought the moves needed their own dynamics or something.
Well, there's
I think it was a game that was quite infamous for having, like, its own physics or something.
That was a Lara Croft game, what do we do?
Was it? Oh, yeah. I didn't realize it was a Lara Croft game, but they were going on about how it was interesting.
Like, right now, I think we're just
they had special coding to make.
Because what we're doing for Lara Croft is they designed the character perfectly
wrong,
and the animators and the designer accidentally decreased the boost by like 90%, and then they like the design too much. Like that's literally
what
they are.
They're likely to have focus tested design,
yeah.
and they will always go to the design that is the most popular. And what we've got is codes now for the overt sexism isn't maybe there. So women will look at Elsa. Or look at
complex,
princesses, but all because she's empowered and
yeah,
she doesn't need a man. It's somehow
it's
a balance, and it's a shot.
It's
not. And I think the difficulty is to not.
This is like a
cast
moment
of
fantasy information
across. This is about character design, and it's about the reason why, you know, sexism and gender bias, not that sexism, just rebrand. As a researcher, or a sexist, or a gender
biased,
it desensitizes you,
like in my case,
whether you're male or female, but it desensitizes you to the more kind of bottom topics. You can have your own opinion. It's about sort of being able to dig and think the more you dig, the more you understand. I think how do you become
Oh, yeah, yeah, because
it's
always like when you look at theoretical.
Okay, Benjamin's saying it's
been good interaction. Personally, honestly, why I really enjoy drawing really
yeah,
female characters is one, well, I find the shape really interesting,
yes.
but also
yes.
because I don't feel that you have to make the female character.
Whoa!
She can take it more seriously as a character.
Yeah.
I'm just like, no, she
what?
Can still be interesting as a character and be like a woman
yeah.
for one.
Yeah.
Yes, and
I'm not worried about the royal tea,
it's even worse.
No,
this is what it's more about
that is
actually
not necessarily.
Most women in the year is
deliberately trying
to be married, like
to make
married and get married at 14. If they're not,
What I was saying is, if you take, for example, this shape, how do you make this male strong? But how do you make that same thing female?
Yeah.
And
shy.
And
how
do
you?
Well, we're just trying to
make it strong. So take that and then apply it. So it would be if I make a male version of this, I would probably make it smaller. Similar to this, but
you think?
And then
we're working a basic triangle and we need to make
them all.
Femme fatale.
I think so, yeah.
So we have dude, shy,
so
femme fatale.
And you called that in the wrong way. Present this because we're going to be doing it quite under pressure. We've got to get through them all in sort of 20 minutes. Yes. I want you to present your experience. There is no right, there is no wrong. There is your experience in doing this. You will not be judged in any way, shape, or form. I want you to talk about what is significant as a group, what things you feel are significant. There's no agenda, but I'd like you to talk using some of the language we introduced today, so coding or sort of gender bias or that sort of thing. Okay, so do you guys have a system for me to present?
Sure, I do. Yeah, we do. And what's our system?
You guys are playing with
my hands. We'll work up above our hands.
What do you need? Is it for me or something to make it?
Ben, what's your favourite?
What
adult?
Is testosterone?
Do you like all of them too much? Can't pick a favourite. Your favourite.
I can present.
Is there one someone like you?
Yeah.
Oh, that's cool.
It's Chris.
We all love it. Oh, we're all quite good, quite emotional.
I'm sorry if I'm coming. No, honestly, it's fine. I'm just I'm listening, but I'm like,
okay, attention.
No, it's okay.
No, you can actually talk about it.
I mean, what if you see my cross t-shirt?
What's it like? Do you want
to the rabbit?
Okay.
It's taking that whole time.
I don't like, actually, I don't want to talk about shy.
If you're going to do it right.
Big rabbit, shy one, and then you also have the bad character.
Oh, then? Can you see him?
I got the strong male.
Let me see what you think of the strong
male. I've true you.
Oh, no.
No, we got a real. We're all doing robots, so it's.
Okay. We done?
Yeah.
Right.
Pass.
Give it.
Good one.
Every
robot.
Every robot.
So, oh come on!
You look more like a dog.
I mean, I agree with you, but not get involved into the conversation.
Continue to try and focus, but once you feel that you've got it's in focus and we can see it clearly, hit the freeze button. Because otherwise, if you're gesticulating and your hand passes over it, it starts to, so we're kind of squinting to see. So as long as we can see it to that level, I'm just going to run through some of these designs very quickly. So this one, if I unfreeze it, character's name is Squirrel. But that is, do we think that's male or female? Do we think, and I'm not going to sort of say who's drawing this which, but.
Just looks like a squirrel.
So, the person who was drawing that, do we think that that person would have said, I believe this is gender neutral, or they would have attributed a gender to it?
They probably
use it. Judging by the name, I don't know. It's
they could have given it their own gender, whoever.
Well, that's not, I'm not going to reveal that, but. The character is loosely described as animal, and the gender is male.
How did you draw?
And the decision was made when the person was asked to name the character. So that's interesting, that it was a gender-neutral character, but when they had to give it a name, the name is gender-neutral. It could have been Mr. Squirrel, or Mrs. Squirrel, or Brunhilde, or Nigel. It could have been anything. But at the point, and this is the subject that I'm most interested in, is at the point where you are forced to confront gender. The point where the first time you have to refer to your character as he or she, it tends to default to he. So this next one I'm going to look at, we're not going to look at all of them immediately, we're going to get you guys up in a second. So, that's the character. The flower was drawn before. So what do we think with that character? Male, female, gender neutral?
Gender neutral.
Male?
I attribute male, but it's kind of gender neutral.
It could be gender neutral or it could be male. It actually could be female. It could be that one could be anything. But looking at the lack of coding, at the point where that person was had to assign a name, that person would have had to then make a decision. So the name could have been Chicken Soup, which would have kept a gender, you know, you could have called it Andy with an I, and then we wouldn't have known. But the name for this particular character is Fred. So that is indicative, and the character is male. The gender was decided on when this person was asked to name the character. Okay, so again, at the point, so when it was being drawn, it was mostly gender neutral, but it was unconsidered, or it hadn't, it wasn't the primary goal of the design. at the point where you have to name the character. We'll look at two more, and then I'll get the first group up to talk about what they're... So that one.
That's clearly female.
Clearly female.
Male.
Male. Who thinks it's male, uphand? Who thinks that was, from the beginning, was drawn as a male character? Okay, leave your hand up if you think it was drawn by someone who identified as male. Okay, so, character's name, and this was one of the ones where some of you were asked to name the character just to reveal the methodology here. Some of you knew that you had to name the character before you drew it, and some didn't.
Oh.
Yeah.
You had to name it first.
Some people, and the word gender was in the instructions. So that's the interesting thing, is to actually look at those two groups and see where the differences are. So this person knew that it could be male, female, or transgendered, and they chose to draw male, and they chose to call it Clyde. The naming is quite important, because the name makes you think gendered, almost exclusively. If I put a kitten in the room and told you to name the kitten, most of you would ask, is it a boy or a girl? Before you'd name it. Even if you're going to call it Fluffy, or you know, Scruffy Drawers, or something, you'd still want to know if it's a boy or a girl. So this particular one, interestingly, has described their character as non-human, non-animal, so it's other. The gender is described as male. I decided on the gender of my character before I began to draw. So that's really interesting, that when the word gender appears, it's quite resolute before the decision is made before the drawing. If the word gender hasn't been mentioned, then the gender of the character becomes more arbitrary. Okay, so what we'll do is we'll get the first group. So I'll start with you guys. If you want to just come up, and what I'm going to do is we've got 5-6 minutes for each group, so I'll have to move it on quite quickly.
Because Jack has to leave.
Oh, sorry, yes, thank you for reminding me. I told you to remind me, Jack. Oh,
let's go like...
Okay, Jack, okay, if you guys go, have you 5 minutes?
3 minutes.
Okay, we get you guys up. We get Jack, let Jack go first, and then you can leg it as soon as you've gone. And this is very informal. These aren't presentations, so, you know, question. You're allowed to kind of, you know, throw a suggestion.
You have to leave.
But, so, tell us about this.
I got the shy, pretty cat, and I couldn't think of much fun to do with it, to be honest. I couldn't think of many fun things to do with it.
Now, isn't that interesting? So, it's a female character, it's shy and pretty, and
the only thing I really did was give it eyelashes and a bow, I felt.
Well, I think the word fun is quite interesting. Did anyone else find that they felt they'd gotten the short end of the stick because they had the shy, pretty character? No? Okay, alright, fair enough. Anything else that kind of occurred to you while you were drawing, or...?
No, I didn't have many ideas other than big eyes, petite, like, lower face, and then, yeah, eyelashes really, and then the rest was just cat, as I had drawn it.
Very beautifully drawn cat. anybody else want to make a comment, or anyone else have a question on Jack and his shy, pretty pussycat?
Why is she sad?
I think shy took her turn for sad at some point during drawing it.
Sorry, I meant shy.
I think the cross pause is, it's, you know, that does sort of, it's that sort of.
Oh.
No, I think it does look a lot sadder than, looks like it's been punished rather than shy.
If she's shy.
Yeah, she's hiding in face or something, but I drew it quickly.
Sorry guys, 1 second.
I need the legs.
Give me guys. Yes.
one for sale. This is the masculine cat, so you can see he's your typical Hollywood male. He doesn't give a fuck. He's got his abs out and his Adonis V. And...
So this is the femme fatale?
No, the masculine one.
The masculine one. Sorry, I thought you said femme fatale. I was like, wow, that's subversive. Well done, you. Well, okay, yeah. So this is the masculine one, yes?
He doesn't give a fuck. He's like a moody kind of like male lead. He's got his chest hair and sunglasses.
Hey, anybody have a comment or a question to make on that one?
It's amazing that he's like pretty much fully nude except for sunglasses and a man head.
Say that again?
He's fully nude except for sunglasses and
cats don't wear clothes.
What kind of conversations were you having when you were making that, when you were drawing it?
I'm mostly trying to stop Mike drawing a penis on it, to be honest.
Yeah, that's what I do. So, you erase it.
Okay, so that's interesting. I'm going to tease out that penis slightly. Why do we feel... What do we feel about the drawing of the genitalia?
I felt like I couldn't do it because I'd run out of space.
Okay.
He already drew that
one. Can I ask the rest of the groups? The other two tables? Do you have a comment on maybe why there was a slight area of tension around the drawing of the penis?
Well, I guess it would sexualize the character, sort of, but then it's
Then my original intention would be ruined.
But it's like, why you decided to draw like the genitals of this character and not on like the shy kitty?
That's an excellent point.
Shy sort of implies that you're not gonna do that, right?
But a lot of porn has the word shy in it, and it's just the way in which he holds himself while still having a pussy out.
Yeah, but those are not characters, though.
I'm just going to steer this van back away to the edge of the class to say there's this point that I've actually found in sort of teaching, running gender sessions. I've run sessions on gender identity with undergraduates and in visual culture. There's an unease about genitalia. Unless you are expressing in that genre, there is an unease. There is a way of... Even things like trouser bulges, there's a point where it's not about your intention as an artist, it's about a sort of a squeamishness about what does this say about me? Or is this appropriate or is this not appropriate? And we don't really have time to tease it out, but it is something that you see often when you ask somebody to break the rules and do something offensive. The thing that they often pull back on is simple biology, the thing that actually is the main coding factor for our gender identity.
Well, for me, for this one, if I had more space, I'd given him trousers because giving a man trousers puts the emphasis on their upper body, and men are shaped that way, the center of gravity is higher, so I feel it'd be more masculine to have him wearing trousers than having him fully naked.
But it also says something about a shirtless man, doesn't it? It's that sort of frontiers, hero, rip his shirt off and he's about
to... I was going to say that that it's almost sexualizing the maleness with the abs and the musculature, because that's generally what people tend to do. Because penises are ugly.
Well, that's a subjective view. I'm interested about the head shape. I quite like the
square. Well, cats are obviously very circular, but made square.
Because why?
Because it's masculine.
So again, we're coding this, so you've done exactly what I've asked you to do, which is to put in almost the stereotypical codes, the memes almost. We're kind of getting away from tropes now, really. Excellent. Anything else you want to say on that one before we look at the next one?
I was going to say the same thing about the tail. There's adding artificial angularity to something to make it more male.
And it could be a stylistic device. It could be reminiscent of an image of animals, but I don't even want to get in there. Okay!
I did wonder about how I could have made it look more penis-like, but I couldn't think about it.
You did very well. Excellent. So thank you very much. Woo! Next.
All right. This is the Alpha Tom.
So.
I don't know, man. What comments do you seek out of
it? The only thing she's wearing is Yeah. Wig. Oh, and the wig, yeah.
So, talk us through it and then we'll throw open to comments. So,
why
I
tried to make her mean and sexual all at the same time, and because she's a cat, it's good in action. I chose not to present other parts that would make her female, except for, let's say her legs. They are a bit like normal human legs. And, the secret, the love one?
Yes.
The one that you see in like all the movies. And eyelashes and long hair.
I think you've done exceptionally well in coding without humanizing.
Yeah. Well, I kind of humanized her a bit.
A little bit. But things that. Can anyone recognize something there that's quite a common strategy for sort of female animals?
Curl tail.
The curl tail. Any idea what that might sort of represent or be or why?
It sort of reminds me of it lagging the salt she has around the neck, the kind of feather boa kind of.
It's kind of that really that when you say curl tail, do you mean her tail or do you mean the sort of rough thing that's
I would say both in a way, but I also see the most kind of glamour, specific to the femme fatale.
I think it is that feather boa idea, but it's a very convenient way of not having to draw something that creates a lot of anxiety, which is human breasts on an animal, which causes anxiety, unless you're doing some very niche kind of animation. it's a strategy, but it's very effectively employed, and it's on Lady and the Tramp. It's on the aristocrats, but particularly femme fatale, because it trope suits, it ties in well with that sort of faded glamour. You'd imagine if she's about to start singing, I'm so tired, in that sense. Anything that sort of went through your mind, any sort of conflicts or things that you needed to kind of work through, or was it a pretty straightforward?
Well, at first I was making the tail, thicker with that, and then I changed it because the things that you said. And the legs, they were more cat-like and they had no boots, and then I decided to make it a little bit more human and add the boots.
Yeah.
And to make her actually sitting and make her have this position. So she would be more female and more attractive, let's say. But the evilness is all, I think it's always in the facial area, I mean the eyes and the lips.
You've had pipes, and that's quite common with femme fatales. They're always smoking really long pipes.
But I think the evilness, I think, is the combination of the cigarette and the boots. She's not shy. She's not innocent. She's not someone's mum. And she might be, but that's an overt point. Do you know what I mean? She's been coded for a very specific narrative purpose. Now, whether the narrative that this character was designed for actually subverted that isn't the issue. The issue is she's been coded very carefully. It may turn out that she's actually the hooker with a heart of gold, has 5 foster children at home, but that's how directors, sort of subvert narrative and subvert their or make their audience take them down one path and then lead them down another. So that's another reason for coding, is to kind of camouflage so that the character isn't so easily read. And that's a problem with pretty shy characters. It's hard to camouflage them. They are what they are. The only thing they can become is feisty. You have an evil shy girl at the beginning, or an evil shy, it's been a long day. You have a shy, pretty girl. Her natural arc is either to remain shy and pretty, or pie and shitty, which I nearly said, or for her to come out of herself or to challenge or to take. So a lot of something like Caroline, or a lot of these arcs are about the shy character developing.
Or they go crazy, or it turns out they seem pretty and shy, and then it turns
out they tend
to
be exact.
The more you got to know them.
So it's a sort of a metaphorical coding. But excellent, well done, wonderful. Okay, very good, next group. And we're going to move a little faster. I just want to make sure that we've got a bit of time at the end to wrap up. Well done. Okay, now I don't mind if you want to throw over back and swap drawings and stuff, because you've got quite a lot. Just move it down. You have to
move. We could go through the drawings first, and then we made a list of the
actually, that's a really good thing to do. That's a
the circle, the roundy thing. Just move her down a little bit. Yeah, that's fine, that's right. Fine, yeah. Okay, so what we're going to do, guys, is we're going to look through the drawings quite quickly. Guys, can you focus, please? We're going to look through the drawings quite quickly, and then we're going to go through them again. So that's the first, so the shy, pretty one. Shy, pretty one. Could you get them all up at the same time, actually?
We can get two up.
Yeah. Oh, sorry, yeah.
There, we can do freeze. Mm-hmm. Just hit the freeze button again. There you go. Down, move them down a smidge. Okay, so we're the shy, pretty one, and I presume the femme fatale.
Yeah.
The evil femme fatale. And the last one. But I know you've got different versions, so we can have a look at the different versions.
Yeah, we
selected.
Okay, so this is your masculine one. Unfortunately, it doesn't zoom out any further, but I think you can keep, just move him to the side so we can see a bit of him. And then you can move him back in and out of your
seat.
Okay, yeah, there we go. That's all we need to see. That's brilliant. Excellent, well done. Okay, so off you go.
Awkward questions, did I do those first? For the shy, pretty one, does this look too much like a child? This was like one of the initial drawings.
Just leave it unfrozen because it's going to be a pain. Yeah.
Okay. No,
it's alright.
Does it look too much like a child? We all got really creeped out. I feel so awkward drawing boobs on a rabbit. That was for all the sexy ones. And
can I just ask who was that? Everybody, or was it just one or two?
It was me.
Just yourself.
Yeah. And when drawing the male character, the thought of make him look more violent to make it look more masculine.
Okay. Who drew the male character?
Mm-hmm.
And was that something that you discussed, or was it just something that you felt personally that more
it's
violent?
Just how I drew the character. I think Laura Beth mentioned it, and then I was like, that's a bit creepy. Or like, that's a bit weird to have to make a male character.
Hands the conscience.
Yeah. To make a male character look aggressive, to make him masculine, which is a bit worrying.
It's a very established trope, but it is changing. A lot, but it's the bad guy is usually quite big and quite bulky because of the threat of violence and the kind of gangster trope almost.
Look like a very weird family.
Yeah,
they actually could be from the same film, which is great. Right, over to you guys. Comments, thoughts.
I picked up on between the femme fatale and the shy character. The amount of clothing, covering up. There's baggier clothing on, and more clothing on the shy characters. It's the Velma versus Daphne type Scooby Doo short. And then it's obviously very different with the femme fatale. There's more flesh on show. Classic trope.
But isn't it interesting that it's not so much how much flesh, but where the flesh is?
Yes.
Cleavage means she knows what she's doing. But a little short skirt, she's so innocent and cute. And it is slightly dodgy ground to tread. It's one of the reasons why I didn't want to get into looking at anime or manga, because you could have a whole week of just looking into the culture and the history.
That's kind of what I was taking inspiration from.
But it's, again, this could be the femme fatale could be the younger character in later life. You know, when it all went wrong. can you tell me what's going on with the ears on the two female characters?
They started working as hair.
Yeah.
So one reads as much as the one acts like a very sculpted, lacquer, whatever.
On the evil character.
Yeah.
Anybody else have anything, any interpretation on the hair on the evil character?
And again, it's just glamour just because it's coiffed.
Well, I actually read it as horns, and I thought, well, that's a really interesting thing. I read it as well. Devil's horns.
Yeah,
that was quite nice.
That's funny. Dear old children.
Go ahead.
But again, looking at the coding, the red lips, the big eyes, the eyelashes, it's the same coding for the two characters, just treated in a very different way. Well, your little character doesn't have red lips, but she's got the large eyes. And then with the male character, anyone have a comment? I know it's late in the day, but it's...
Like the tattoo.
The tattoo, yes. Other than I like, can we...
Well, he has a larger mouth immediately, and larger top lip, more space in between.
He's rectangular, it doesn't have any curves.
So, large mouth, square or jaw,
yeah.
And rectangular, so that it's this notion of a square, meaning sort of masculine, strong, kind of almost hero. Well, he's not, he's kind of baddie, but... Anything else that you guys want to say about that particular character?
He's got hair.
Sorry?
What do you hair? Got a chewed up ear.
Yeah, no, I didn't even see the ear. I did see the hair, which I thought was... Is he a rabbit or a hare?
Oh.
But the chewed up ear, again, you know, there's some really nice detail in there from character design, but from a sort of gender perspective, you know, well-coded, three well-coded characters. You wouldn't be in any doubt as to what they represented. Anything else that any of you guys wanted to bring up about your discussion or your process?
I think, because I found it really uncomfortable drawing the first shy rabbit, because I was like, this looks too childlike, but even when I tried to make it more adult-orientated, it still seemed really childlike.
It's more creepy when you do the adult one. Put the child one back on for a second. I think the one you put on there is actually slightly more disturbing, because she's got a very childish face and much more adult proportions.
Yeah, very
I feel like it became more sexy, less pretty.
But isn't it weird, because that's the brand that sort of, that genre treads, it's that child woman.
So I felt so uncomfortable doing it.
I'm beautifully drawn, but freaky. Freaky. Anything else, anyone wants to sort of make a comment on any aspect of it, or anything else we want to? No? Excellent, well done, round of applause. Okay, and you guys, do you want to hop on?
Here you go, Emily.
Oh, thanks. I don't mind what way, if you do them individually or together as a group, whatever's easiest.
Okay, we're trying to put them all through together.
Don't worry about the freeze button, because it's not working. If you put them all together and then you can kind of cover them up. Yeah,
there we go. And then we can move between.
Yeah, oh, good thing. So I now know the next thing I do is to give you smaller things. Huh. Excellent. So, who did what?
I did this one in the middle.
Okay.
And I did Ted Kennedy on you.
So tell us what we're looking at.
Who wants to start? Right, I can start. Basically, I have the pretty shy one, so... I gave her this sort of shy pose. Mm-hmm. She's like looking up, she's slightly smiling, and her eyebrows are like this. She's sort of fairly feminine.
Yeah.
She has like a slim waist, a bit of a voice. It's a bit covered by the hands that she's supposed to have.
So she's been coded, but she's not terribly sexualized, which is...
Yeah, I tried not to sexualize her. I tried to use this much as less sexy as possible. Yeah. And huge eyes. Yeah.
Okay, cool. And who did the vampy one? The wicked demon?
Marius the evil. Sexy evil.
I think you succeeded.
We tried it based on basic, what do you call
it? We went with like...
It's about a robot, and we tried it like from with a head, just one head and torso,
right,
two arms, and wheel, legs. So I just developed the character based on and it's because there is an evil or female character, so I just developed it based on some basic traits of the evil, evil queen.
She's evil.
She can wear a heavy makeup, red lip, a
embarrassment drawing the boobs? Did you think I'd rather not do this? No? just out of interest.
It's just drawing, so
yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah.
And what I quite like about this one is the proportion of the head. Did you deliberately make the head sort of that very slim? It's quite slim. Yeah, that's nice. Why did you make that decision?
Yeah, the character, the evil female, can be brown and maybe thin and slim. Yeah, I just pick one.
So. Can I ask the group, looking at this, what is that character? What traits Lynn has drawn that particular character in a way that differentiated from most of the pretty shy characters?
She looks older.
Older, good.
By the first glance.
With the very sharp sort of face, which is really like a big contrast to the whole sort of babyish, like huge eyes.
Yeah. So it's not the mother, the soft, slightly rounder, same face but slightly bigger, which is the sort of mother trope. The evil female trope quite often has these cheekbones. It's something we recognize the code.
Yeah.
But why? And one of the reasons is to make that character older. They're past their prime, they're no longer desirable, and that's one of the things, especially in Disney, that makes them evil, that they're jealous of a more desirable, younger character. But it's also about authority, and authority figures have the idea that this character is regal, the high cheekbones, the attitude and the way they're drawn. So again, it isn't just, oh, because that's how other queens are drawn. You've got to dig a little bit deeper. But really nice drawings, really nicely done. Good, and we can have a look at the Mercubot on the other end.
The classic heroic body shape, shorter legs. I gave him, because we were all meant to have like the clamps instead of the hands, so I gave him bigger ones, squarer ones. He has cuffs, he has a tie, I thought you could either go one of two ways with a classic male character. You can either go for the Jackie Gleason blue collar, or you go for a successful white collar. So I also gave him the very nicely parted sort of haircut, very square jaw. Also, I've also given the smaller eyes compared to, especially with the shyer character, heavier brow, square nose, wider mouth. I had a little bit of the, you can see it in the drawing actually, I had a little bit of the conflict with the hip shape, because generally when drawing veiled sort of figures, you tend to, if you're doing a construction drawing, it's almost drawing a pair of underpants that have the pelvic shape.
Yeah.
So I had a little bit of a conflict when mentioning
the... You can see the conflict.
With the bulge.
We can see that you were in two minds.
Yeah, a little bit. I was, yeah. So that was my main conflict.
Was that purely a drawing aid, or was it that you weren't sure if you needed a crotch or not?
It was because I wasn't sure whether you needed a crotch or not.
So it was a sort of an anxiety or a conflict?
Because it started off when I was drawing it, I wasn't thinking like that, but then it was afterwards that I started second guessing.
But isn't it interesting that where we kind of tend to have conflicts aren't about, is it right for the character, is it right for the narrative? It's like, I don't really want to have to think about the bulge, so I just won't put it in. Or if I put it in, how does that change what I'm communicating to my audience? In a way, it's linked to what we talked about with Tarzan. Oh, we don't know how to deal with the sort of native characters. It's dangerous territory, we just won't put them in. Or we will put it in, but we'll explain it away because it's, you know, Minnie's panties supposedly were about, just to show that it wasn't Mickey. It's like, well, she's got a flower in her hair and long eyelashes and a dress. It wasn't about that, but it's easy to explain, you know, to contextualize it in that way. What I really like about these three is that they're actually really very much responding to each other. So you've made decisions on this one based on how the female characters were shaping up. And I think that's led to particularly with male characters, some very traceable decisions. So things like the size of the eye is small to differentiate it from the... You could flip that on its head and say the female eyes are made bigger to differentiate them from the male. So you can't overlook that, that you've got to represent not just two different genders, but, you know, evil characters, young characters, old characters, sympathetic characters, you know, all of that kind of thing. I think he looks like a thug. I think he looks like a football manager. He looks like kind of a thug done good. You know, he's got that Neanderthal brow.
Yeah.
Do you ever read Terry Pratchett?
I don't. I know a little bit.
There's a lot of those characters in Terry Pratchett, but the idea is that they're small businessmen who've done good, and sort of come back and they're wearing diamonds and they're, you know.
Kind of looks like robot Donald Trump.
I did say Ted Kennedy. He's Kennedy Bob.
Anybody got anything they'd like to say about those particular drawings?
I loved the variation of shapes, like the clearly masculine one was all blocky. The shy one was circular, and the evil Fenrir was all pointy. I thought it was and also the difference between the shy one and the Fenrir Towers, the Fenrir is very, very feminine compared to the shy one, which is quite simple, it's got quite a simple body shape.
I think with all of them, you could put all three groups, you could use them as illustrations of gender coding. And that was sort of the point, was to get you guys to put the theory back into practice. So anything else anyone wants to say on these three before we wrap up? We're all happy? Excellent. Round of applause. Right, thank you guys. We're going to very quickly, because we've 2 minutes to go. And what I want to do is swap back over to PC. And I have to flip back, so just to remind you all. Oh, there's one slide that I missed that I did want to come back to, which is apropos of nothing. Has anyone heard of the Smurfette principle? Very interesting, but the idea of a female character in animation basically being the female within an ensemble cast of males. Type in the Smurfette principle, and there's a couple of articles. It's not actually a theory. I couldn't find any theory book or any papers written on it, but I just thought it was interesting. I put it up there. Also, I quite like Smurfette. So. There we go. Right, so we're just going back up through at all that we've done today. And I just wanted to come back to the aim of the session. So the aim of the session was to help you to identify and sustain essential connections between your personally held values. We can now say personally held values. Today, we modeled this on thinking about gender and animation, but this could be thinking about issues of race and representation. This could be ethical issues about how certain stories are presented to children in children's television. This could be wanting to make socio-political commentary. There are a bajillion contexts in which you can place the process that we went through today. So this isn't about how to do a particular thing. It's when you find your personally held values in terms of your own creative outputs, and they will be different for each one of you. Some of us don't like to draw boobs. That's a personally held value. Some of us loved drawing boobs, but maybe didn't particularly want to make our characters smoke. I'm just clutching here because it's been a long day, but every single one of us is slightly different. We have our personally held values in relation to our own creative output. That could be design work, that could be script writing, that could be performance, that could be your animation as itself, in and itself, how you animate something in a broader context, how your film plays out, how your stories are told, how your audience consumes those stories, how you code your work, how you choose not to code your work. Okay, so broader contemporary debates on the forum. We looked at a few. We looked at animation in the news. Really, really good bit of advice. Try and do that. Put aside half an hour once a week to go and see what's being written about. What are people getting excited about? And try and do it beyond the process, beyond the technology, beyond the creative process. Try and look a little deeper. Look at things that have touched a nerve politically, socially, culturally. and then looking at the established and emergent theory. We looked at the established theory, so I talked about Paul Wells and I talked about King. Emergent theory, I sort of deliberately am leaving that one to say that's the sort of take-home message. That's what I want you to do, is to start to look at emergent theory, not necessarily about gender, but look at theories that have been formulated now. You are the people who are going to be forming parts of the next round of animation theory. You are going to be people who are making the changes, or you're going to be people who are commenting on those changes. So to try and encourage you as MA students to for that sort of deep level thinking, that investigative, curious approach about how things are changing and where your place within that is. So I'm just going to leave you with that and ask any questions. Did we have a good time?
Yeah.
Did we learn things?
Yeah.
That's all that matters. Thank you so much. Thank you very, very much for doing the research project. I am going to ask Chris if I can do this again, I think. But we'll do it in... You just want to go home. Go fuck it off the stage! I'm going to ask him if I can do it again, but after your hand-ins. And I'd like to do it again in looking at male, and I really want to do one looking at transgender characters, which is a very small study, but I'd like to kind of complete the set. So I let you know, and thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yay! Now you can give your round of applause. Yeah, there we go.
Thank you.
Yeah, you were confused. You gave yours earlier, so. You can take your drawings. If you want to take your drawings, you can leave them on and onto them. If you want them, you can take them away. And if you can just make sure you got all your bits and pieces. And we only overran by 2 minutes. So if you look for that on Blackboard tonight, it won't be on because the adaptive release is, I think, 7 o'clock. Because I knew there'd be things I wanted to put on there. Because I should be able to read these.
I haven't really been doing stuff since.
That's fine, no, I totally get that. But like,
I'll do some stuff first.
Also, just in case, like, you may or may not have seen it, the deadline for the thing tomorrow is 1 p.m.
Yes, yeah,
to make sure you
are. Send it tonight.
I wasn't. I mean, it's fine because I sent it this
morning,
but I wasn't.
It's Friday, so it's
oh,
chill.
Yeah.
It's lovely. I was like,
thank you.
What? That's why I haven't really done the
so actually,
I was
just
done
do
that.
No,
I totally get it.
No,
I was
in
the presentation for the of men, when people say, like, oh, comic book heroes are sexualized, they're like, no, it's a power fantasy.
Yeah.
Like, they're not portrayed anyway. But there's a, it's Japanese, unfortunately, Japanese animation about male swimmers, and that is purely created for females.
Yeah,
is
it
free?
You know, the male characters being sexualized.
Yeah.
But there is a, I'm trying to think of who it is, I think it's in that animation aesthetics. They say there isn't so much energy put into talking about male sexualization because it's a male fantasy. They're sexualized to be heroic.
That's the argument people are saying that comic book heroes, it's a power fantasy, not sexualization. If you actually look at the sexual, because women are better at toying it than men are, let's be fair.
I mean, touching that with Birchbowl or gay men or whatever.
But their idea of sexualization of men is very different from a man's.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, like big muscles, big everything. It's like, no, we want really sexy and suave and stuff like that. Well, that's just a generalization, but I'll send you.
You know what was really interesting was one of the things that I had to strip out about 40 slides because I had men in there, but I got to the point at the weekend where I'm like, this is just too big. Sorry, you and a mad rush. But the one of the interesting things was they were talking about narratives, and I had to sort of back off not getting into narratives because that would have extended it. But men in narratives, something like Op.
Oh, yeah.
There's a lot written about how that is not your traditional heroic male arc that you know you have. And in terms of race and in terms of questions about representations of race, you have, oh, what's his name? Go. But you have, go
can
on.
You please, can you please book another, you can make it book an optional, like make an optional session with us about this.
I am going to do this.
We will.
I will. See you. Take care. But the idea that the little boy is mixed race, but it's never mentioned at all.
Yeah, I think it was just as you had to assume that he was.
Yeah,
it should be mentioned. Like,
no, I think it's good that it wasn't, because it's like that's what life is about.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So, if you made it about, you know, he had to overcome something because he was mixed race, that's not as.
I think about that. That's interesting. Yeah.
Or that the male character, because he was over the age of whatever, 65. Isn't your typical male hero.
Yeah.
He's not a father figure. So it was very, that was considered, in terms of gender and men, that was considered a real breakout role. So
yeah,
read around it, because it's quite interesting.
And I'll try and send you those cringe-worthy
things
that I can possibly think of. Because like there are so many instances where it just completely turns it on its head, and they're so overly sexualized in terms of visual.
Do you know if it was directed by female, male?
I can find out, but it was based on it was an advert for swimming, and then all the females were like, this is amazing, can we have more? They made two seasons out of it. And there are so many like interesting essays that people have written about it, but they're kind of, they're sexualized visually in terms of the way they act.
Because
you've got, I think there's five main characters, and one of them's like aloof, the other's really fatherly and family orientated, another one's really cute, another one's really embarrassed, and another one's really like tough. But it's so interesting, I'll find the most cringeworthy thing that I can possibly can.
Do you know what? I should look forward to it. It's my little treat.
You've sent us an email from you.
Sorry. Oh, yeah, sorry, I've just gathered up some work away. Sorry, I'll send you an email.
So I can, because I can't remember your email.
It's mary2.murphy, but if you go into, do you know the Weebly site? Do you know how to get into that? No, okay.
I think you have sent me.
I sent an email to everybody from Blackboard, I think. Do you know what? I'll send you an email tonight, and then
just remind me.
I'll do it from Blackboard because it's your UE address through Blackboard.
Yes.
Yeah. No bother.
I just think that if you're going to do one about men, I was like, she has to. Well, she has to.
If it's after your hand-ins, what I might do is ask, you know, with three or four people, would like to put a case study on.
Oh,
and
yeah,
give you time to prepare it, which would be quite
that'd
interesting.
Be really interesting.
So say if we had a little platform where you had a 5-minute case study that you could sort of bring in and discuss and open up for discussion, that could be more useful, I think. So we can do that.
Yeah.
I think Chris, I had a quick chat with Chris at the break, and he was quite up for doing it again.
Oh, gotcha.
But making it maybe non-compulsory so that if there are people that aren't interested, it's not such an exciting thing. But thank you very much.
All right.
Thank you. Take care. Huh.